Oh, there. Savior, our healer. Worship you, Ancient of Days. We my Savior, my healer. Oh, there is no like you. And I worship and I bow down before you. For there is no like you. Not in the heavens, not in the earth. Oh, there is no like you. Lord Jesus, my Savior, my healer, there is no like you. And I worship and bow down before you. There is no like you. Not in the heavens, not in the my Savior, my healer.
Oh, there is none like
you. And I worship and bow down before you.
Oh, there is none like
you. None in the heavens, none in.
Oh, there is no like
you. Lord Jesus, my Savior, my healer.
Oh, there is no like
you. And I worship and bow down before you. Jesus, Savior, God, oh my being. Oh, your love fills my being, and your mercy rushes over me. It's your mercy rushes over me.
Your love,
your love.
Sweet,
sweet to my soul. So sweet. So sweet to my soul. So sweet. So sweet to my soul. So sweet. So sweet to my soul.
Your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. Aleluia. See Manaya, see Manaya, and among Iran. See Arabaki setting in a manane. Open wide the gates like fire, like water, like the flood. Your presence like fire, it's like water, it's like the floods of rain. Hallelujah. Well, that's exactly why you're supposed to go to enter into a room with the Lord every day and begin to let the Holy Ghost show you how to function in this realm. And it's not going to happen watching television. It's not going to happen washing the dishes. It's not going to happen complaining about your situation. It's not going to happen doing your everyday normal things in life. It's not going to happen because you're out having fun. It's going to happen because you're willing to enter into a place that's labor, a place that's new and different, a place that you're now going to be privileged to be taught. You can keep playing until I say stop. How about let me just lead for a little while? And then as time goes on, you begin to have an increased capacity to receive what God the Holy Ghost is giving, because you've been willing to be taught of God. You've been willing to be trained. You've been willing to be given the tools and the skills. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Say, Bakaya Shepotoya Mate. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Bakana ne eche kiata hamora sikana. Hallelujah. Osikani akapakai. Hallelujah. Tandom bronzageya. You were born of the Spirit to function in the realms of the Holy Ghost. Papa wants to make you able ministers of the Word, able ministers of the truth, able ministers of the gospel, not by the letter which kills, but by the Spirit which gives life. Because if you got somebody who doesn't know how to flow in the Holy Ghost, handling the Word, it is a terrible, frightful thing. And you know, I'm just so blessed as I'm watching different people, you know, I've watched people over my lifetime step out of the ministry and begin to do things, and as they allowed God to give them skills and abilities. I was spending a little bit of time watching Kelly Leger today. He's up with Debbie Rester and formerly Debbie Rich. Some people know her as Debbie Rich, and just watching as he's just flowing in the anointing and preaching the gospel. Hallelujah. Preaching the word, and Paulina and Angelo and others that have just recently, you know, started being able to go to different places and doors opening up for them all over the United States of America, different places of the world. Just hearing them going after it and declaring the things that Father has given to us. Hallelujah. When we were born again, when we were raised up from the dead, when we were given His life. Hallelujah. And this is a cuddle. And amen, Isaiah. And this is what we believe, God, for you as well. And you're, you know, I tell you, I've watched as some people, you know, I watch as they become so filled with the word that I tell them, you know, there was different folks along the way in my life that said, you know what, you become so filled with the word, you do not know how much word of God you have in you. You sit here and you've received from the anointing, hallelujah, and it didn't look like there was a lot happening, but you were having a good time, amen, and you were always receptive. You were never a hard wall. You were never off over there doing whatever or resisting. And as a result, you're able now to give, to begin to give out of the sacred things which you've received. So you're going to have to make everything that Father is doing in this place sacred, because if you don't, you might just end up, well, you will. You will end up doing things that you don't want to be doing against the Holy Ghost. And so you've got to just, you just got to learn that you here in this place here tonight, not just to sit around and worship, which is a wonderful thing to do, don't get me wrong, not just sit around, hear the word, which is a wonderful thing, don't get me wrong, but to now be also prepared of God to be used by the Lord. There's so many anointings and so many giftings, so many different dimensions of the anointing and the giftings, because, you know, when we talk about the anointing of the Holy Spirit, we're just talking about Jesus Christ being revealed through our life. So when we say, Lord, I want a greater anointing, really all we're saying is, Lord, I want a greater display of your life and your power revealed through my life. And there are things that have got to be corrected in our life. There's things that have got to be changed, and there's things that we've got to be willing to receive from God and participate with him, follow the Holy Ghost in, for that to happen. When we say, Lord, I want to increase the anointing, we're simply saying, Holy Spirit, I want a greater flow, unlimited flow, of your divine power through my life. So you're in school, and you're supposed to be in school all day long, and Father is giving you the best teacher and mentor that you could possibly ever imagine, Hakato Maseo, hallelujah, that you could possibly ever ask for, praise God, the Holy Ghost. Amen. Holy Ghost. And he's going to teach you, and he's going to instruct you, and he's going to do it through his apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. And what we're going to do is we're not going to teach you to have a dependency upon us, but we're going to teach you the Word of God and the principles of God so that you can hear from God, so that you can be filled with the Word and live by the Word and walk in the Spirit. Now, what happens is when we lay out for you the logical progression of God's Word, declaring to you this is what you need to do, this is what you must do, and this is what you must not do. If I tell you, for example, if I said you should never go and buy anything or participate with Starbucks, that would be one thing. But if I say to you, you should not go there because the leaders of that company said if you buy anything from us, basically you are committing and submitting to this idea that homosexual marriage is equivalent to traditional marriage. So every time you're paying them, you're saying, yes, I agree. And so I can convince you then from the scripture that that is evil, that that is the highest form of desecrating God's temple, that there is no way for you to defile yourself on a different level. And then if I really started bringing out more of the details, of, listen, the siren that's there over that building is actually an image of Ashtart, or which is the queen of heaven or the mother of harlots, which is the one that Jeremiah the prophet was after, that Ezekiel the prophet was after, and that because of all that she has done, and people are going and they are actually imbibing their pleasures under her banner, then all of a sudden that should bring up another higher level, but I should never have to go to that. But this is what happens. This happens all the time. So then what happens is people don't listen to the principle of the word, the reasoning of the word, and they do their own thing. And what takes place then is now you're no longer protected. So you want God's protection. But you know, the more that you give yourself, for example, the more you depend upon Father's provision for your life instead of you doing being your own provider, and usually that really comes down to the way that you believe God in the terms of finances and the way you give to God and the way you're willing to move in the faith of His provision because He wants to give you great provision, then what it does, it also works out in your life where you depend upon Him for your protection too. And you depend upon Him for your perfection as well. And thus you're able to receive. So I'm depending upon Him for provision and I'm able to receive His provision because I grow in that realm of faith. Well, the beautiful thing of it is while I'm growing in that realm of faith for provision, I'm also growing in the realm of faith that receives protection and perfection at the same time because I am just so laying hold on God's word. I don't want it any other way. So God puts rulers and leaders and overseers in your life to perfect you, to bring you in and to build you up and to mature you. Now listen, I've watched this over time. I can tell you who's going to go into ministry and go out on the field and be successful, and I can tell you who's not going to be. And it's not based upon any special insight or discernment that I have that God gave me in a dream or in a vision. It has simply to do with the way people respond to the Word of God. Because we love the encouragement of the Holy Ghost, and we love, you know, the comfort of the Holy Ghost, but not a lot of people love the correction of the Holy Ghost, which is also His instruction or His rebukes. But the reality of it is those come to us for our own protection, for our own perfection, and for our own provision, so that we can learn how to just receive everything the Holy Spirit has given. You have to learn how to walk in the disposition of Jesus of lowliness and meekness before you're ever going to really hook up with the Holy Ghost at any real level. And you're never going to learn how to walk in lowliness and meekness until you come under the authorities of those that God has placed in your life. And it's supposed to start off with mom and dad. And mom and dad was supposed to be teaching you how to walk in the ways of God, and many of you unfortunately missed out on that. Mom and dad was supposed to teach you how to obey, cast vision for your life, help empower you, and a lot of people miss out on that. And then many people have gone through just a terrible kind of, you know, lifestyle of being caught up in the world and influenced by all of its rebellion and all of its stubbornness. And then, you know, you come in, you give your life to Jesus, and you're born again, and you're made a new creation, and everything is supposed to be starting new. Now your spirit is made such that the Holy Ghost can come rule over you, and you're supposed to learn everything on a whole new basis, but unfortunately, many people allow the former conversation to come and influence them. Hello. You got to study. You got to understand how not to let the world and the former conversation, your own thinking, your own way, the model of man, the model that you learn, to influence you. You have to understand that everywhere you step out of lowliness and meekness, you step out of the ministry of Jesus. You step out of a place of being hooked up with the Holy Ghost so you can flow with Him. Does that mean that God doesn't like you anymore? No. His mercy and His love continues to reach out to us. He draws us. He'll let you feel His presence. It's not an affirmation. It's a mercy. It's not God saying, okay, you know, everything's perfect. It's the Lord saying, come on now, I love you. And then my presence good is like fire. Praise God. You know, now come over here and learn of me. Come over here and understand the disposition of the divine, of humility and the brokenness. The Lord says, this is where I'm going to dwell. The person is a broken and contrite heart and who trembles in my word. These things aren't hard to understand. And where you're really going to be tested is when you are confronting a person like me. When somebody beside you is in charge. We want an invisible person to be in charge, like the Holy Ghost, that we can basically pretend like we're obeying them when in reality we're charting our own course. God wants to teach us how to be led, how to come under His authority, how to be His slaves. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How to be His servants. So we teach you how to think for yourself. Hallelujah. In other words, we teach you how to walk in the mind of the Spirit yourself, how to walk in the mind of Christ yourself. But we teach you on the basis of learning how to live by the Word of God and learning how to walk in the Spirit. And so a lot of the instruction and a lot of the things that are going down is, hey, you're not doing that. You're not stopped. You got to understand. You got to learn how to be obedient. You got to learn how to follow leadership. You got to learn how to stick with the company. Yeah. I guarantee you, if we were out in the desolation unit, out there where you can walk for days and don't know whether you're going in the right direction, huh? And it was that time of year where all the bears are out. And let's go on up to Glacier National Monument and let's go across the border there into Canada, and it's just nothing. They're nothing. And if you don't know your way around the woods, you'll never coming out of that wilderness. But now you got somebody who's a guide. And there's big, crazy looking, huge grizzlies and all the other kinds of animals you don't want to come up against out there. And there's some man-eaters out there. And so, And most people are scared of a coyote howling at night, and a coyote's more scared of you than you are of him. What are you doing when something's running down your tracks and you don't know where to go? Guides are good then. Leaders are good then. I guarantee you, you're going to go exactly where the guide's going. You're going to be right there, keep him in sight the whole time. You're not going to like, well, I'm going to wander off over here because I really don't think he's going in a good spot, you know. I'm going to check out what's over here. I'll meet you guys tomorrow morning. You're listening to me. We in a much more impossible realm to navigate than that. That's child's play. That's child's play. You hear me? Yeah. It really, truly is. We in a realm where none of us know where to go. The Lord tells us to place one foot in front of the next by His Word. And so I'm going to talk to you about that tonight. I'm going to start off and minister to you out of Romans chapter 13. Hallelujah. Pakoshi Nankana. I'm going to tell you something. Father put great protection upon you, but if you're not going to obey Him, you can go on and do your own thing. People, you don't understand it. Most people don't understand it. You're really up against spiritual wickedness. You're really up against angels of darkness. You're really up against people that are out there that are serious about their sorcery, about their witchcraft, about their ungodliness, about their antichrist spirit, about the power that is in their life, the demon spirits that they don't even know some of them are in their life. But those demon spirits, when you begin to communicate with them, when you begin to interact with them, you give them place. When you hang out with people all day long that are in the depths of iniquity and sin, if you don't know how to walk with God, if you don't know how to stay in the realms of the fire of God in relationship with God, there's no way that you're going to be coming out without the smell of smoke upon your garments. That stuff is going to mess with you. If you don't know how to say no and shut the thing down, I mean, literally, people think that, the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb and loving not our life even unto the death is something for the tribulation. You're in tribulation right now. Hallelujah. That great company in chapter 7, an innumerable company dressed in white garments, they came out of great tribulation. Those are all the people who went through all of the stuff since the days of Abel. Okay? That's that great company. Hallelujah. And you in tribulation, you in great tribulation, you up against it right now, and there's no way for you to be successful unless you're filled with the strength of the Lord and power of His might. And we want to teach you. I want to teach you how to be an overcomer, man. First and foremost, I want you to get to heaven. And then secondly, I want you to be able to be used to God. And I know how your response is because I know what the Word of God does. It's a light. And when it shines on you, I'm telling you right now, things get to be shaken up and it starts moving around. It starts moving around. And some of the times you're just going to have to buckle yourself into the seat. You're going to have to buckle yourself. Just tie yourself in. You're going to have to understand how to tie yourself, as it were. Bind your hands and bind your feet and tie yourself to the horns of the altar, because you have no right to use your hands anymore for your own will or your own self. You have no right to use your feet anymore for your own self, because you said you're a living sacrifice. I know you saw that living sacrifice out there just walking around, just doing whatever you want to do, having a good time, enjoying life and praising Jesus. But that's not what a living sacrifice is. Jesus shows you what a living sacrifice is. Hallelujah. It's not to do our own will, but to do His. It's laying down our life for a lost and dying world. It's laying down our life for the brethren. It's not living for our own self, but living for Him. And no price is too great to pay. So you bind your heart, you bind your hands, and you can't move around no more. You bound your life to the horns of the altar. And now you learn to live by the Word. And then that means you're going to have somebody looking at you going, hey, wait, what's up now? You got to have accountability. How many of you don't like accountability? Come on, go ahead, raise your hands. Accountability to who? Yourself? You want accountability and you want transparency. People go hide out in big churches because then they can just live however way they want to. I'll tell you right now, I'm not coming here to evaluate you, but you come in here to be evaluated by God. You come in here, let the Holy Ghost shine His light upon your life, and you're so excited about it because you want to be corrected. You want to be instructed. You want to know how to move with Him. Man, I'm going to tell you right now, this is the great life. This is the fun life. This is the exciting life to step over into a place where God can fully be manifested through your life. And you're like, you're the only problem. You're the aggravation for yourself. You're the one that creates all your own problems and depressions. You. You and you alone. And God wants to get you out of that mess. Hallelujah. He wants to teach you how to live the blessed life with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places and be provided for with everything that you have need of according to His riches and glory. Hallelujah. He wants to show you how to live as the representative of heaven every day, showing that you are so in partnership with God that you choose what God chooses. And you reject what God rejects. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So many people, if they were given the position of Jesus, they would have never gone stood in line with the transgressors. They would have gone out and stand on the shore, watch all the prostitutes and the harlots and tax collectors and thieves and liars go stand down there. When you guys done, I'm the Son of God up here. When you guys done, y'all clear out. Then you're going to have to make room for me because I got to get baptized too. Huh? It's true. Because we create for ourselves, because of our insecurity, we create for ourselves false support. Yes, we do. That's where we've got to have somebody tell us that we're doing okay. You can never make it in ministry if you need anybody to tell you you're doing okay. Do you understand me? Hallelujah. Praise God, turn me up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Katodosai. Except for God, the Holy Ghost, He tells you whether you're doing okay or not. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the living God. So we want you to come just humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and understand you're never going to have a ministry until you humble yourself to the ministry God's already ordained in your life. That's what Jesus went and did when He went to John and said we must fulfill all righteousness. He stood there in line with everybody else. Until He got up with John, everybody, no one knew where he was, a bank robber, a liar, a cheat, huh? What he was. It wasn't until He got up there in front of John. John goes, what are you doing in front of me? I have need to be baptized to you. He said, no, you do what's right here. I'm going to submit myself to your ministry so that we may fulfill all righteousness. Because now the Lord's going to, you come to prepare my way, huh? You come, you're the first wave, and I'm just going to be here submitted to your ministry. Did Jesus need to be baptized with water unto repentance? No, He was submitting Himself to an anointing and a ministry there. So, well, I can forego that because, you know, that's John's ministry and that's for everybody out there that doesn't know what to do. Huh? Everybody who's messed up real bad. Are you listening to me? Yeah. I hope you can understand what I'm saying to you. Because it has a huge impact on whether or not how much God's going to be able to use you. And you have to decide. You decide. How much do you want to be used by God? And if you are serious about being fully used by God, He's serious about fully using you. He's serious about you having not only His ministry and the exploits and the glory of His ministry, but something far greater. You decide. You decide. You're making choices all day long. Some people are saying silver and gold, not you. Huh? Sorry, silver and gold I have, and I don't have anything else to give you. How much money did you need? We'll help you out with the money, but we can't say to you, rise up and take up your bed and walk. We can't tell you that. We have to come to another place. We're going to have to understand that Father's word can't be compromised, will not be, and you and I have got to learn how to live by the word and walk in the spirit. And that's what we're here to do tonight. I mean, praise God for the worship and the singing. It could go a whole lot deeper. Father wants it to go a whole lot deeper, but there's got to be things going on in your life on Monday and Tuesday for it to go a whole lot deeper tonight. Had to be things going on in your life today for it to go a whole lot deeper tonight. So how hungry are you for it to go deeper? Or you just want to just continue to go on with just whatever, little you have or whatever little you might expect. No, that's your decision. I pray tonight that every one of you, and I'm going to tell you right now, if you want to do that and live like that, you in the wrong church, you're going to be so miserable all the time. You can always feel like a wretch in this place. Huh? Hallelujah. I told somebody the other day, I said, well, they were ministers in a certain place. I said, you can't minister like I minister at the Bible place. I said, that's SEAL team training there. I said, over there, you're going to have to, you got to go real gentle and real slow and expect an amen in the first 2 years. Okay? And then after 5 years, a good hallelujah. And then maybe after 10 years, a tatapara. I mean, this is going to go slow. You got to go slow with people. You really do. In most contexts, it just because people are so involved in everything else. And if you don't go real slow, you're just going to lose them. Hallelujah. And, you know, I was just thinking and considering today, custom. Get up there and sit down. I was thinking today about how many different places. Say, you think that she, like, doesn't feel like I love her? No, but she can feel like that, hey, she's going to have to do something she don't want to do. And that's where people all of a sudden say they don't feel loved. No, you just don't feel like you could do whatever it is you want to do. Ha! That's a big, gigantic difference. Okay, if you think love is a permission that you go do whatever you want, that is not love. Because Father showed us love that has got a whole lot of strict obedience to it. Praise God, if you love me, I'll keep my commandments. Amen. I was thinking today about just thanking and praising God for this facility that He's given us here and how many people labored, especially in the year 2015, to go from house to house. How many people stepped up and said and committed, you know what, I'm going to live 2015 for the Lord on another level, like I've never lived for Him before. And most of these houses around here receive some kind of a message, some kind of an invitation. We probably reached out to at least, I'm going to say at least 10,000 people. I mean, with in terms of the car washes, a total number of doors that were knocked on in a year, and actually a little over a year and a half. And then God has allowed us to do that in so many different areas in a community that's over 3 million people. And this is what we got. Amen. So I say that you're an elite team. Amen. And I'm really interested in your children. Hallelujah. God's interested in your children. He's interested in bringing some people upright. Hallelujah. God, so they might have some upright in the earth. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so if you just obey God, do what God has told you to do, just with all earnestness, Father, I want to serve you. I want to do what's right, and I depend totally upon you to do it. My goodness, you just now opened up the door for all heaven to be able to come into your life and come around, camp around you, and organize and strategize for you on a daily basis. Hallelujah. Now all I got to do is hear what they're saying. Hallelujah. And praise God, we get to hear exactly what they're saying, exactly what they're planning, and exactly what they purpose to do right here in the Word. And then God's going to bring someone to you like He's brought me to you, and He's going to begin to lay down the Word to you. Now, if I tell you to walk in my own opinion and preferences, I've violated authority. But I'm not telling you about my, I've never told anyone about my own preferences and opinions. I will outline the Word of God to you. And I will say, because I process this way. I process this way with my wife. I process this way with my children. I process this way with you. I process this way with people out there that don't know the Lord. I just bring it down in the context of what does God say in His Word. And I lay that out before you. And then I say, this is what you should do based upon what God said in His Word, or this is what you shouldn't do based upon what God has said in His Word. And then ultimately, you're supposed to come to a place of being taught of God where you do the same thing, where everything about your life, you process it. Can you fix this mic a little bit? You process it, okay? In the sense that you're thinking out your decisions and your reactions based upon what God's Word says. That's called the renewed mind. Hello. Everybody's running around wanting to get a renewed mind, don't even know what one looks like. I want me one of them renewed minds. Will you fix my mic, turn it up a little bit, and just come give me a low end so I don't have to strain talk. And so a renewed mind, don't be conformed to this world, but be transfigured by the renewing of your mind, okay? The renewed mind, okay? Hallelujah. Praise God. It's simply thinking different, and it's thinking according to the Word of God. It's processing according to the Word of God. Hallelujah. And it's not doing it out of some kind of a legalistic manner, but out of relationship and dependency upon the Holy Ghost. Because are you begun in the Holy Ghost now to be made perfect by your own human ability? No. If you're depending upon your ability as your provision for yourself, you're never going to have God's provision. He's going to stand back. He's not going to mix it up with you. And this is so hard for people to get. It is step number one in the Spirit. And if you just grab a hold of it, here's how you grab a hold of it. With a smile and a yeah. You may not understand a single thing. Most things about Father, I do not understand. Just read the Bible more. You'll have a whole bunch of things you don't understand either. I just know who he is. He's great. He's wonderful. And everything he does is out of the realms of love. And I mean, this goes beyond me, but I'm saying, amen. Praise God. I'll do whatever you tell me to do. I don't understand it. I don't understand a lot of the decisions that the Lord made. And I know the word of God pretty well. But there's still many things that's like, okay, Father, I just bow before you. Because you know things I don't know. You understand things I don't understand. Your decisions there are perfect. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, how about the person out there in the middle of the jungle never heard? Where are they going to go? I'm going to tell you right now. They are going to go to an eternity without God. That's where they're going to go. And if they got a heart to get it right, God's got a way to get somebody there to tell them about it. That's just the way it is. That's hallelujah, because that's the way the Lord does it. I can prove that to you. But nonetheless, there's many things I don't understand. But I obey. How much of you did you understand when you were a child and your parents were telling you what to do? Like, make your bed. You don't understand why you need to make the bed. You're just going to get it in at night anyways, mess it back up again. You know, it goes on and on and on. We're going to have to learn how to obey God's word when we don't understand. We're going to learn how to give thanks and be happy about it and receive. And it's so easy when you learn how to get drunk in the Holy Ghost and stay there. Amen. It's so easy to listen to a preacher like me talking with my veins popping out the side of my neck. Hallelujah. Praise God. I've discovered how hungry people are out there for the word, good word of God. I've discovered how hungry people are for the things that the Lord has entrusted to me. It is amazing to me. And I'm just blessed. I'm blessed to go out and see people going, oh, amazing. Don't leave. Tell us more. This is amazing. And then, you know, join in. And it's part of the reason I started doing face streams, you know, and just, you know, find other ways to communicate the gospel to people hungry. What are you doing with it? You're just like, oh, okay, well, we're used to this. This is pastor's. That's what pastor does. Ah, praise God. Amen. No, you're never going to receive anything that way. You got to be hungry. You got to say, wait a minute, there's something going on here. I'm special to the Lord. You say that, I'm special to the Lord. You could say that. Say, I'm special to the Lord. And he sent me here. Hallelujah. Said to receive something special for him, from him. Hallelujah. And you know, somebody's telling you something that's just a bunch of nonsense of just proclaiming things that have nothing, very little to do with the word. People just seem to be receptive of that. But when you should fully reject that. And so tonight I'm going to just help you a little bit here in Hebrews chapter 13. Hallelujah. Verse 1 says, let brotherly love continue. Amen. That's a good one right there. Praise God. Halavakataste. And I'm going to tell you who defines brotherly love. And that's Christ Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, when I look around and I see people not obeying their leadership, I'm going, my goodness, you just are so far from you're so far from the kingdom of God. You don't even realize it. You don't listen to your leadership. And when you don't listen in one area, you don't listen in all the other areas either. You just listen in those things which you can agree with. God's not trying to teach you everything you already know. And turn me a little bit. God's not trying to teach you everything that you already know. He's trying, he's laboring to teach you that which you do not know. Hallelujah. That which it's not very comfortable for you. Hallelujah. It's something that you've got to change about the way you do things now. Hallelujah. Praise God. And it's a challenge for folks. But that's how you get to go start flowing in signs, wonders, and miracles. That's how you get to start flowing in the gifts of the Holy Ghost. That's where you, when you go step into prayer, all of a sudden it's like fire. Hallelujah. Whew. It's like water. It's like floods of rain. And now, you know, everybody's going, you're going to love to go there every day. Amen. Bondesh take care of you. This is Wednesday night's supposed to be so important to you. You're supposed to take a nap so you're not sitting in here tired and yawning. Barely can keep awake. Lord, I spent my whole day on myself, and now I'm trying to just get some time in here for you. This is a holy thing. This is sacred. And when you begin to count it holy, you begin to count it sacred, and you lay hold on it, there are skills for you to receive here. There's divine abilities for you to receive here. I've watched, as I said, I've watched the different people go out. I mean, I can take, just because I just was with Kelly today and spent some time with him. And, you know, he's preaching tonight up for Debbie Rester. And, you know, there was never a time he came in a meeting that he wasn't just laying hold on everything. Anything I asked him to do, he'd do it. I mean, I could say, lay down, I want to wipe my feet on the back, your back. And, you know, I would never do that. I'm just telling you, it's just that level. It's just that level. And when you get to the place with the Holy Ghost like that, then you get to have everything the Holy Ghost gives you. But when you're like just dicing it out, well, I just don't understand that. I just don't feel it. I just can't go with it. You know what? You're going to live in a realm so isolated from all the abundance that God wants to give you. You're going to have to learn how to be a servant when you don't understand. You're going to have to learn how to trust God. And really, this is what it's all about. That's where Adam failed, was trusting. That's where Abraham succeeded. That's where you and I are being tested. Are you going to trust God that he's brought you to the right place? God, did you bring me to the right church? I guarantee he's not going to answer that. If you start praying, Lord, did you bring me to the right church? Heaven will be silent. You will hear nothing. Huh? You ask enough times and Satan's going to try to get in there and go, no. But obviously he loves you. He's drawing you with loving kindness and tender mercy. He's there to keep you, watch over you, protect you as much as you allow him, provide for you as much as you allow him. I'm just pleading with you tonight that you would fully allow God to protect you, and you fully allow God to provide for you, and you fully allow God to perfect you. Because when you let go and you let God move in, you'll live in an overcomer's life. It will all change. It's like you go to sleep and wake up in the morning with his likeness. That's how much effort. When you step over in that realm, all of a sudden, you're not your own keeper anymore. You're kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. I'm ready. Hallelujah. Why? Because I'm not my own keeper anymore. I'm not trying to make my own decisions anymore. I'm a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. I'm just here to be turned into smoke. Everything I got is being burned up continually. Hallelujah. You know, I'm tied to the horns of the altar. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm just here as an offering unto the Lord. I'm here as an example that communion's taking place between God and man through Jesus Christ. Can you get that? Because that's what you signed up for. If this is bad news to you, I can't help you. This is supposed to be good news. This is what you signed up for. You signed up to lose your life. Hallelujah. And people have a hard time with that. But when you recognize, wait a minute, I got God's life. I got the life of the Spirit. I got the life of the Christ. Then you're willing to say, you know what? I'm done with my life. I hate my life in this world. I mean, my goodness gracious. Who wants to live like me? Amen. I want to live like God. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to live in his beauty, his splendor, his purity. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't want to run any risk of going to hell forever. Amen. I have a great fear of God. Amen. A great fear of God. Hallelujah. I'm going to walk with him. I'll learn how to obey him and everything. I'm going to depend upon him for everything he's got. He's my own hope. Yeah. Without him, there's no way. I can't make it. I can't be what he wants me to be. And so I've signed in fully. I've signed up fully and turned myself completely over to his watchful care. And that's a decision. Every day, if you start to defend yourself, you start to take up your own program, chart your own course, do it your own way, you're just telling the Lord, you can't take care of me. I'm going to do it my own way. I'm going to live with my own results. You don't want to do that. You need to be kept by the power of God because you do not know. You do have. You have no idea. You know, I tell people, I've been telling people, the book that I've just finished and that Charisma is getting ready to publish for me will shake people really hard. Some people go, well, you know, what you're saying here is that a number of things have got to happen before Christ Jesus returns, and so he can't return at any time. Yeah, you could derive that conclusion, but let me tell you something. You don't know when you're going to die. Amen. You can die at any time. Hello. Yes. And that ought to be bigger to you than anything. Amen. Because at the moment, it just is big. Hello. It's just going to come just as suddenly. Hello. Hello. Are you ready? Are you doing everything in terms of standing with the Lord, giving an account? Today, this morning, when I woke up this morning, I said, Lord, I know, and this is what we should do every morning, and there may be different ways for you to say it, but here's the way your heart should express it. I know that I must give an account for this day. Good or bad, I know I must give an account. And Holy Spirit, I ask you to cause me to be so sensitive to you so that I do it your way, so that I don't end up in trouble. Lord, I'm not big enough to take care of myself. I'm a little baby in your presence. I'm a little child in your presence. And I pray that you'll cause me to really believe that. one, two amens when the place should be a roar. But praise God, you grab it. When you say amen, everybody else is in there going. It's true. Because we don't want to understand it. We don't want to grab it. You got to reach out and grab it. For you to go, amen, you got to say, I'm going to change. For you to reach out, for it to be there. I want that. I want to believe that. Because this is wisdom too high for you. Only the Holy Ghost can make this real to you. This is just the way it is, people. You know what? You can say, oh, it's coming down on me. It's condescending. Yeah, it is. Okay? I am coming down on you. And yeah, it is condescending because I can't help it. I mean, look, you know what? You've got to have to be willing to let the Spirit of the Lord take control of your life and recognize that all this stuff belonging to the pride of life is just as bad as the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. And pride and arrogance and stubbornness and doing it your own way and thinking you know yourself something is nothing more than an iniquity. And it's going to keep you from ever growing. Hello. Hello. Ah, see, kind of month. Wake up. Spiritually, wake up. It's time for you to wake up. It's time for you to quit sleeping. When you're sleeping, you never change. When you're sleeping, you continue to do everything that you've been doing because a spiritual awakening has not come to you to show you the importance. God, that's not Father's fault. God always has a spiritual awakening for everybody at this moment, right now, always. He's not going to force himself upon us. He will not force himself upon us. You got to lay hold on the good word of God. Hallelujah. As I believe, therefore I speak. Hallelujah. I'm going to declare these things. Amen. I'm going to learn how to follow them. I'm going to learn how to follow pastor's faith. True. True. And right now that's me. Amen. And pastor being a shepherd is something that Father's put in my heart. It's a delight to do it. It's much easier shepherding sheep or shepherding cattle because it's easy to get them to do what you want them to do. You just got to know a few tricks, huh? Hey, baby. Huh? It doesn't necessarily come easy to learn it. Yes? Huh? But eventually you can get them to do exactly what you want them to do. It's not so with you. It's not so with you. Listen to me. Listen to me. It's not so with you. It's not so with human beings. Because right now I'm talking and trying to get someplace in the middle of your thoughts. I'm trying to find some place to fit into the mental of into the mentality of that way in which you live. And you got to bow for God to get in there. You got to bend. You got to bend so low. And your society and your culture has not taught you to do that. Your society and your culture has taught you to compete with me. And thus not be able to recognize that the Holy Ghost is speaking through me or other people like me. It's always this comparative thing and always this competition thing. It's a demonic spirit keeping you from receiving from God and living as you're supposed to. I mean, you know, it's God's realm is totally different. Competition, comparisons, compromise. These are all demonic things, but we're very skilled at it. We're skilled at it. Competition, comparisons. You would not believe the amount of decisions that you make based on comparisons, the way you feel about yourself based upon comparisons. Because it dominates you. It's a demonic realm that dominates you. It's a mentality that dominates you that only the Holy Ghost can get you out of it. People do not realize what they are up against within the framework of a society and a culture where the God of this world, the spirit of disobedience, has by and large designed it. You will not find competition in the Bible. Or compromise in the Bible, or comparisons in the Bible. You will find the opposite of it. Thus, you and I have to, with a regenerated mind, learn how to cast that stuff down that's contrary to the knowledge of God and the obedience of Christ. But so many times we line up things for folks and say, this is the stuff that you're going to have to cast down and bring into captivity, and it's like this blank stare. I want you to grab a hold. I want you to get your pen and paper out. Listen to me. I watch people, preachers, sit in while I'm preaching and take 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 pages of notes while I'm talking. Hello. When's the last time you took notes? Think about it. How, and really, somebody's, well, I'll just listen, let the Spirit of God. He's looking at you and seeing how hungry you are. He's looking at you seeing how desperate you are. I'm telling you tonight, the floodlight of heaven is shining on your soul. And by the time I get done with you in the scripture, you're going to say, my goodness gracious. Now, I don't want you walking out of here going, my goodness gracious, again for the umpteenth night and not doing anything with it. Hello. Why? Because the laborers are few and the harvest is plenteous. And it seems like all the wrong folks seem to be going with all the wrong motives. And I want to see God raise up some people in this place that will lose their own life, take up their cross, deny themselves, and follow God. The Lord isn't going to come build you up with these things and the anointing for you to just go on and live your own life. You don't need the anointing to get up and do whatever it is you do at work. You don't need the anointing to eat food, go to sleep. Are you listening? You don't need the anointing to drive your car. Maybe some people do, but for the majority of people, they don't need it. But to walk in supernatural exploits, signs and wonders, set the captives free, to be used of God everywhere you go, to touch people's lives and see them transformed by the power of God, you need the anointing. Yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. Where's Josh at? Hey, Josh, you need the anointing. Hey. Hallelujah. Especially if you're going to try to minister at UCSD. Hallelujah. Or state. Or wherever. Kanaman Jessikita. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So I'm just going to try to focus in on just a couple of verses of scripture here. So verse 7 says, remember them which have the rule over you. Or you can just break it. You can just dilute it a little. Who have the leadership. Huh? Remember them who have the leadership over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God. That's important. Hello. Hello, Mangeshti. Hello. Whose faith follow, considering the end of their lifestyle. Now, how much of that are you going to obey? How much of this are you going to obey, and how much of the time? Because there's two variables. Two variables. Variable number one, how much of this are you going to obey? Because there's a lot to obey right here. And variable number two, how often? How much of the time are you going to obey this? Now, what you're doing with that is you're making a decision. You're choosing how much God is allowed to have rulership in your life. How much God is able to touch you. How much God is able to strengthen you, empower you, change you, develop you, mature you. That's what's going on. That's the process. Because I think some people listen to me like they listen to a Bible tape listen to scripture being read on their CD player. Listen to scripture. You're so used to listening to scripture, you can drive, talk to somebody, write a couple of notes, take a couple of telephone calls, and right back over there, scripture being read. It's just background noise. We want this thing, we want what God has for you tonight to be received into your heart. You know, what we have to contend with is that basically 10 to 20% of the people receive from God. This is the statistic. 10 to 20% of the people grow. 10 to 20% of the people receive healing. 10 to 20% of the people really obey and go all the way. The rest of the people just come and participate. That's the statistics. When you've got a full-blown revival going on, it might go up to 30%. Well, that's wrong. Are you the 10% or are you the 90? You can't all be 10. How many people in here tonight? Let's just say that there's 60 people in here tonight. 10% is 6 people. Well, let's have a full-blown revival. 18. I'm messing with you. I'm trying to get there into a place of where you, whether or not you're going to make some decisions tonight. Yeah. I say, I'm going to mess with you. I say, come to prayer. You can't get here. Why? Could you get to work? What's valuable to you? If I say this is what God is doing, how many people show up? What's valuable to you? How much are you going to obey them? How much you go, really, let me just say it in a way where you can handle it. How much are you going to obey the Holy Ghost? Everybody's going to, 100%, praise God. But you know what? There's nobody really looking into your life on that one and holding you accountable on that one. Are you listening to me? That's why the Lord sent apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers to get right up in your face and say, how much are you going to obey? I'm going to obey everywhere I agree with you. I'm going to obey every. Look at this. Remember them let's see, what word can I use here? Remember those who you tolerate, who have spoken those things that you agree with. So you have to say, how much of the Word of God am I going to obey? How much of the Holy Ghost am I going to obey? The Lord says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Don't be carried about with diverse and strange doctrines. You know, I like to springboard off of that. Really, with 2 Corinthians chapter 11, I just want you to look at that real quickly. Just a second, can you hold your finger here on Hebrews chapter 13. Go look with me in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Listen, let me just tell you. Let me say something very clear to you. Can I be very clear to you?
Yes.
I have no desire for you to obey me or do anything for me.
Right.
I want you to be. I want to be painfully clear. I'm not interested in me. I am here about the kingdom of God, praying and fasting and crying out to God that somebody would be willing to mature in the things of the Spirit. That's it. Now, God has equipped me with the anointing of the Holy Ghost and wisdom and counsel and understanding and given me the ability as a special gifting to speak on His behalf by the Spirit and not by the letter which kills. Hallelujah. Now, this is what we're talking about here. So really, it's what I am saying is coming down to, I am one of those people that are standing over you, looking at you, seeing whether or not you're willing to obey God's word and walk in the Holy Ghost. That's all the dynamic that is going on here. One amen, four head nods, 20 people standing in a place of total shock, 3 with a sort of grin on your face, and the rest are frowns. You could say, God, help me. I'm sorry. I'm repenting right now. Lord, forgive me. I'm going to get this right. But you need to say something. This is a reactive service. This is one like, you know what? I know what is going on. I mean, when the Lord tells me, listen, don't feel bad, they don't listen to me either. Then I got a responsibility. So you say, when the Lord says, don't feel bad, they don't listen to me either. Then I got a responsibility. Get up in your face and say, what on earth do you think you're doing? Quit messing around with God. Start obeying God. Get yourself in the program. Get yourself in a place. Learn how to be the servant of God. Learn how to serve God. Learn how to make the church the most important thing in your life instead of just what a consequence when you get around to it. Huh? I'm so busy with my money and my stuff and my things and my other relationships that God's got to get the leftovers that I'm going to give them a little bit of yawn and a little bit of and a little bit of hum. Come on, man. Let's get God in here first here.
Amen.
Let's get God bigger. Let's get God bigger. Get God at least 1% bigger than everything else. Get God at least 1% bigger than everything else. At least give God 51% of your day, huh? While you have 49. At least give God 1% more than you give yourself. Think about it. Huh? If I thought every one of you were on your face crying out to God every single day, I'd say, okay, I understand why 3 or 4 people show up for prayer. Huh? But when we say you need to be here for prayer because I'm certain that God will answer what anything that we as a group of people in this church, listen to me. If I say to you that I am certain that God will answer whatever we as a church come together and agree and ask for, you should be so excited and thrilled if you believe a fraction of that. Why is it that God gets the lesser part? Why does the God get the convenience of you and me? Why? And then we go labor for ourselves and sweat and toil for man's stuff and earthly things. Why? You answer the question. Huh? But I'm going to tell you right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, you better get God first in your life, and you better learn how to mind spiritual things, and you better put your life on an altar. Otherwise, you're running risk of eternal ruin. You listen to me. I know what I'm talking about up here. So quickly, let's look real quickly here at 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and Paul said, "Would to God you could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me." He says, "For I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." So he says, bear with me if I seem silly to you, but I'm jealous over you. You belong to me. That's what he's saying. I'm the one who got you hooked up with the Lord. And then he goes on to say, "But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For he that comes to you and preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or whom you've not, or another spirit which you've not received from us, or another gospel." And he lays it out. How is it that for some reason you're able to put up with them? They're telling you I'm preaching another Jesus to you, and some people translate some of this as these guys present themselves as super apostles. Because I'm an apostle, you recognize I'm an apostle, but now you put them above me because you're going with whatever suits your fancy is what he's telling them. It's what the Lord says. He says, the Lord is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is the same as he was in the Old Testament. Peter says the same thing. A day with the Lord is the same as 1,000 years. He's not changing. He feels the same way about things. He's given us an opportunity right now to walk with him, and we're just prioritizing God. Hello. Listen, if you're going to learn how to mind and participate with spiritual things, it's a labor. Hello, let's go ahead and just get to work. It's a labor. It's a labor as you make a transition from the way you've been living and interacting and socializing now to work and interact and participate with a whole other dimension of life. Because now you've got to get used to being over here in this other realm, where you're not constantly being entertained. You've been raised to be entertained, cartoons. Now, if you can't make cartoons, now a puppet show. And then whatever else your parents did for you to try to entertain you. Are you listening to me? Now it's iPhones. My goodness gracious. Huh? Hello? Huh? Now we put the mother of harlots, Astarte, queen of heaven, witches and sorcerers as dolls for our children and dress them up like that, and it's so cute, and Disney comes up with every evil thing and we like it and go participate with it. And then we got to have, and now, my goodness, what do they say? The way that things have become with the Western society, to do a commercial, to get people to listen to a commercial and to hold their attention, it's got to be action-packed, and you got to have 10 years packed into 10 seconds. It's got to have that much footage, that highlights of 10 years of excitement and every kind of possible, entertaining impulse that pleases the senses. And now we're going to come over here and get quiet? Ruh-roh. No CDs? No puppet show? No drama? No people to sit and smile with? Say, how am I doing now? High five. or whatever. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I'm dealing with you, man. I'm not talking to anybody on the web right now. I'm dealing with you. I'm dealing with this church that God has ordained to live and dwell and abide in Him. And you're going to have to quit doing your own stuff, doing your own pleasure, seeking your own way. You're going to have to start doing His pleasure, calling His sacred things holy, His anointed ones honorable. Then you're going to understand how to delight yourself in the Lord. Yeah, I know the look. I know. I've been here, I've done this a long time. It doesn't take very much level of intelligence at all to recognize what people are going to do with what you're saying. I know from the framework of how people respond to the anointing. Because you don't even do any of this without the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
I understand. When I'm offending your mind, I'm revealing your heart. That's all. The floodlight of heaven's shining down right now. And everything that is going on is being exposed by the Spirit of the Lord. As to whether or not we're just going to be hearers only. Or whether we're going to be doers. You're going to have to learn. Let me just help you. You're going to have to learn a whole lot more obedience than you're used to doing. You're going to have to learn about a whole dimension of a much stricter life than you've been living. You listening to me? Hallelujah. Because we know the severity of God. Knowing the severity of God, the uncompromising, unwavering ways of God, God who is no respecter of persons, but will judge every man after what he says. I mean, I can read here a couple of things to you right here in Hebrews chapter 13, God says, those people who participate in sexual immorality and adultery, I will judge. I mean, when God comes down, I will judge. Watch out, man. I'm moving way back. I'm moving way back because that's like Korah and Dathan. Because he's saying, everybody's on my side, get over here. That's what he's saying. And so I love you, but I'm staying over here. If I were you, I'd get over here quickly. I jump up and run. And really, you have to understand that this is the consequence of the things that we're saying. We're not giving to you optional plan A, plan B, and plan C of salvation. You listen to me. Break off that yoke. Break off that yoke. It is a power of darkness that is keeping the church from advancing right now. Huh? Break off that thing, man. People, I'm going to tell you, you do not understand the seducing spirits and the doctrines of the devils that you're living under. You just think that I'm just saying this stuff. You just think that you just consider for a moment as a possibility, but you go on living your life as though it's not so. You're going to have to begin to start shaking a little bit. You're going to have to know the terror of the Lord a little bit here. You're going to have to understand the severity of God. Come on, you're going to have to understand the critical hour that you live in. You're going to have to understand the enemy of your soul, that he's got an assignment against you. There's only one place to be protected. You have to run to. You're going to have to run to Christ Jesus. The name of the Lord is a high tower. They that run in will be saved. Amen. What Father has given to us in the name of Jesus, that we say, look, I'm trembling. I have the fear of God, but I also have in that respect, I have a great awareness of what Satan is doing. And what he goes about as a roaring lion, seeking him he may devour. And the only possibility of safety is to submit myself to God. Well, how do I submit myself to God? I obey his word. I do what he says to do. When it feels good, when it doesn't feel good, whether I like it, whether I agree with it, whether I understand it, whether I know it, doesn't matter. I just do his word. And if I read his word and I say, okay, this is what I'm supposed to do, and I'm doing it, but I'm doing it wrong, but I'm doing it based upon that's what I think he said, he's going to correct me. No, that's not what I meant. I didn't mean for you to drink strychnine. You hear me? Because some people, they did that. They thought, well, you know, you're supposed to drink any deadly poison. It will not hurt you. And grab some snakes. It's pretty hectic, man, when you're in the meeting and the snakes start rolling down the floor. Somebody starts getting all excited and starts dancing around up on the platform, grabs the basket and pours it out. Now here we go. Slither, 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 slither. And if you lift your legs, that means that you're not been saved. You know what? There goes snakes. And you go, ah! That means you just got revealed. You've not been born again. Get up here. That's hectic. How'd you like to be in a church like that? There's got one right now. If they were listening to the Lord would say, no, stop. That's not what I was saying here. Huh? Meanwhile, they're not getting a lot of salvations. You know what I'm saying? Jesus help us. It's so much more simple. It's just so much more simple. If we say, listen, if you're a youth and you're in the youth ministry, you need to be at the meeting on Thursday night. Yeah. You're not there, you're just disobedient. You're not obeying those who have the rule over you. You're not participating with the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we tell you, listen, here's why you shouldn't do this and go over there and participate with that. And let me give you the reasons. You're supposed to do it. You know what? And then if I'm wrong or a leader is wrong, it's the Lord that's going to straighten them out. It's the Lord that's going to take care of them. It's not for you to straighten them out or take care of them. Amen. It's for you to obey. But what's going to happen is you're going to get so blessed obeying. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, Father's going to take good care of you obeying. Somebody asked me, are those people that do the strychnine and snake handling, what are they going to heaven? Yeah, they're going to heaven. They love Jesus. They're just stupid. A lot of people try to correct them, and they love the Lord. They're just stupid. They needed to submit to people who had more understanding of the Word of God than they did. Huh? And they needed to submit to a more classical approach to Mark 16, verse 17. Well, I want you to submit to a classical approach, Mark 16, 17. I want you to cast out devils. I want you to speak with new tongues. I want you to be confident that you're not gonna have to concern yourself with the threat of the serpent or the threat of the poison. I want you to be confident that you can lay hands on the sick and they will recover. You need to start obeying God instead of saying, well, I can't do that. You need to obey God. You need to do what God says. You need to start living out the divine life that Father has given us to live. You guys need to be in prayer meeting more. Amen. Sikata la Masaya. Let's lift your hands towards heaven right now. Lift my amen. Jesus, touch her right now. Pake la ma. Lift your hands up towards heaven. La Satirania. Thank you, Jesus. I can go down the row with everybody in here. People, what happens is as we step out to obey God, we begin to discover how much of our life is in disobedience. It really is. It shines the light on it. We step out to obey God, we go, whoa. I've been walking around doing my own thing, charting my own course. No wonder pastor's been basically so full of long-suffering and tender mercies. The beautiful thing of it is when you begin to cooperate with the Word of God in a place like this, the receptivity of the Holy Ghost, mangalosa taya, the overwhelming glory of heaven, mandaling tapa. Because we're not ministers of the word, of the letter which kills, but of the Spirit. We're able ministers. We're ministering to you the things of the Spirit. We're ministering to you the Word of God that you do. You're hooking up with the Holy Ghost, and there's all kinds of evidence. Hallelujah. There's a great reward in seeking the Lord. Hallelujah. If there's anything people need to learn is diligence. People don't want to learn diligence. You know how many times I can show you scriptures about diligence? I'm diligent at work. That don't even count. That's not even in the zone. That's about you, man. How about diligence with the Word? How about diligence in obedience? How about diligence and faithfulness? How about diligence in prayer? How about diligence in learning how to move in the things about the Spirit? How about diligence in depending upon the Holy Ghost? Because you recognize that everybody you come in contact with, it was actually a divine appointment. You just didn't have the spiritual, knowledge and insight to recognize it. You're just so off doing your own stuff, you didn't even see it. You didn't even see it. Listen to me. I'm talking about a fun life. I'm talking about the grand adventure. I'm talking about the exciting things. Hallelujah. Where God the Holy Ghost is using you as an heir of God all day long. Amen. As a kupataya. Ha. Ha boshev lekaya. That isn't going to happen by accident. It's not going to happen just because you want to. You're saying that, you know, you want to do what's right. It's going to happen because you're willing to obey God and do what's right. It's because you begin to get desperate about your relationship and who you're supposed to be. You really get serious about eternity and the fact that you're going to give an account for your life, and it's all going to be based on the Word of God. Hallelujah. Listen to me. If you have relationships going on with people who do not know the Lord, what's in their life will be on you. It'll stick on you. Now, what if you're messing around with somebody who's involved in the occult? You could have been protected. All you had to do was obey those who had rule over you and say, listen, you don't have any kind of relationships with people that don't know the Lord. You can love them and bless them from afar, but you live your life by the word of your testimony, by the blood of Jesus Christ, and because you love not your life unto death, you have no fellowship with the ungodly. I can tell when people are messing around. I can tell. And you think, what, I'm supposed to act like I don't see it? I see a wolf standing there ready to, you know, lying, ready to snap somebody's head off, and I'm just going to go, oh, well, praise God, just enjoy the presence of the Lord. No way, man, that's not a shepherd. But neither do I have the right to make you. I don't think. I will make my children. And the one thing that does stand out to me is when the scripture says, if you do not know how to rule your own house, then how shall you rule the house of God? I know how to rule my house. And I know what God said to Abraham. Abraham, I'm going to use you because you're going to command your children. So I really do. Sometimes I struggle. I go, Father, I know that I've got to get up in people's lives some more. But, you know, the ministry around me said, no, don't get up in their lives. Just leave them alone. And I'm like, I've always had a bit of attention there. Because people that are older than me and God, and what I've learned most of my life is you just leave people alone, give them the word, let them choose. That's what God does. Well, I basically, for the most part, I try to leave a limit there, but I can still see in the scripture that goes that there is a conflict, because I treat the house of God in some respects different than I do my own house. Because I'm going to tell you right now, even though Ruth Ann is married to Cade, if I saw them messing around, I'm going, I'd be in there. What on earth are you doing?
Amen.
I'd be there. What are you doing? And then I'd read the right act. And I'd say, you get it right. Huh? And then but what happens is I feel a restraint with many people. If I saw Brittany doing something, I would read the right act to her. I would lay it down. Why? Because there's something about where her spirit is submitted to the Holy Ghost that I could do that. I can do that with Chris. I can do that with many of you. There's some of you I can't. That has to do with your relationship with him, not me. Because he's the one who gives me the boldness and the confidence and releases me with the divine ability to get in there and treat you like a daughter or a son. If you want me to treat you like a peer, I'm sure God's never going to use me in your life. I'm sure he's never going to use me in your life. I'm certain of it. You'll have to go find somebody who can be your daddy, so to speak. That you respect and would honor that way. And that's kind of crude language that I'm using, but I'm really talking to a spiritual state in using that crude language, because no one should have this spiritual state. I mean, we should be able to walk in a place of brokenness and humility before God. We should have learned lowliness and meekness by this time, that the children could lead us, as it were. Because that's really what that's talking about more than anything else. It's just talking about with all lowliness, hallelujah, with all meekness, hallelujah, to be clothed with humility and to walk in love is a totally different disposition than the world. You can't look like and act like the world and think that the anointing is going to be on you. You can't trample all over the Holy Ghost and think he's going to work through you. I'm telling you, walking in arrogance and pride and just simply not walking in lowliness and meekness and submission is trampling all over the Holy Ghost. People don't get that. You're going to have to get it. You're going to have to get it to the point where you're going, if your prayer time's nothing more than, oh God, I want to learn how to walk in loneliness and meekness, oh God. Because what's going to happen, you start talking to him like that in sincerity and truth, and he's all of a sudden you're going to go, oh no. I didn't believe that I had that much of that stuff going on in my life. Because you start asking God, and he starts opening your eyes. And you start seeing. Whew, that's a glorious thing, though. I mean, hallelujah, it's a revival meeting. You might feel sad for a moment because you got to go, oh, God, forgive me. I can't even believe I've been acting like that. No wonder how has it that you've been able to even move on my life or move through me at all up to this point. That's just one of the rewards of seeking God. The reality of God sinks into your soul, and you see. And the beauty of it is now open before you is all those opportunities with God and the ability to be able to receive from him instead of doing what's opposite of him. You can't look and act like the world and be moving in heaven. You can't do it. Hallelujah. That's the whole reason for leadership. Listen, praise God that Moses knew where he was going. Come follow me, guys. Come on, we're going. You going to follow Dathan? Nathan and Dathan? Dathan? Huh? They're going around. They're going to a hole that sinks right down into hell.
Yeah.
Besides that, they don't even know where they're going. At the end of the day, everybody's complaining and murmuring against Moses and Aaron. But when Moses headed out, guess what? He had the cloud with him. Is there another cloud? Does anybody see another cloud anywhere? Here. Huh? There's only one. He's the leader. Praise God for the leader. He's called a shepherd. He's called a pastor. That's what the leader is. Whether he's Moses, he was a shepherd. Whether it was David, he was a shepherd.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God. Jesus is a shepherd.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Pastor or shepherd?
Amen.
Shepherd.
Amen.
Shepherd.
Amen.
Shepherd.
Amen.
Yes. Who loves the Holy Ghost? Who loves purity and holiness and loves the things of God and wants to see the move of God take place? The end of my faith, you could actually follow because its conclusion is in what God wants. See, but you got to decide. And the more you decide, then the more I can get into your life and say, stop that. Because I'm telling you right now, when God does that through me and you on that level and you disobey, there's a greater consequence. There is. There's a greater consequence. I've had situations where I wanted to say something to someone that 10 years went by. Lord wouldn't let me say anything. I'm like, Lord, this is intense. No, say nothing. Another year go by. Another 2 years go by. It's like, my goodness. What's going on? And then finally the Lord say, okay, I want you to tell him this one thing. So this happened more than once in my life. Someone be in church 10, 13 years. Just say one thing to them. Say this to them. I'll say one thing to them. Gone. Immediately they're gone. Because they didn't want to obey. The whole time all God was doing was working to bring them to a place of obedience. That is the stubbornness that exists in the people of God today in this hour throughout the United States of America, thus the spiritual state that we're in. Now, if we're going to ultimately grab a hold of what it means to be a glorious church, a church that walks and moves in the fullness of him that filleth all things, then we got to learn a totally different realm of living, dear people. We got to learn a totally different way. It's lowliness and meekness and servitude is following leadership that God has ordained. It's loving the anointing that's there. The presence of God is being trained and built up and equipped. Hallelujah. I'm certain that it outrages the Holy Ghost that we would be willing to tolerate anything less than a church filled with all of his fullness. I'm certain of it is. And then we have to understand that it's our own personal responsibility. And I tell you right now, I'm going to watch over your soul. I'm going to pray over you. I'm going to run off the devils. I'm going to run off every evil thing that I can see. I'm going to continually stand by you with a spiritual bat in my hand, knocking everything upside the head that's trying to take you out. Huh? Doing everything I possibly can to make intercession for you while you're running offline. It'd be nice for you to get up here, get up close and throw in for a little while.
Yes.
Amen. Run with the program over here. Huh? Group up, recognize, wait a minute, this is not play time. Huh? This is serious business. Coming into the house of God and learning how to move in the things of prayer and the dimension and the giftings and the skills that God will develop in that place where you labor in the things of the Spirit. Those things are not optional. That's going to make the difference of whether you're going to be used by God, whether you're going to get up. I mean, I want Geneva to take off and run all over the United States with the gospel. It's just in her. She's ready. Go. She's ready. God needs that. Father's looking for people with the word of life and the authority of the Holy Spirit at work through their life. There's no reason you can't be that. God's not a respecter of persons. He says, whoever, anybody, anyone who believes this, believes it, is a state of living. Hallelujah. This life, it's his life. Amen. One day I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, should I lower the bar? He said, you lower the bar, you're going to be preaching another gospel. A lot of people are preaching another gospel. They're preaching another Jesus. They're trying to move in a different spirit than what they received. I'm moving in the same Holy Ghost that the Lord Jesus Christ has. Amen. Same one that Paul had. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Still has. Yes. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So I'm in the same church. Amen. You have the privilege of being here.
Yes, we do.
And you need to obey God. You need to quit doing your own stuff. I'm not doing my own stuff. I'm not doing my own thing. This is the kingdom of God stuff. This is the kingdom of God thing. I'm going to trample all over the Holy Ghost with my agenda and then expect him to move, because it ain't going to happen. This is true. Look at verse 17, same chapter 13. Hallelujah. 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 The end of this whole chapter is good. This is a great chapter. There's not a thing in here that I would want to skip over. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And there's some things that might be hard to understand, so they should be taught on. And I really ought to start at verse 1, take you all the way through the whole thing. And how can I do that and be right? Because of the spirit of wisdom and counsel that Father gives to those who he gives an assignment to teach and minister his word. Praise God, by the Holy Ghost. Amen. So we come to you not just speaking with tongues, but we also have with us knowledge, revelation, doctrine, prophecy. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. So you can get it right. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Do I get everything right? No. But you know what? Father is right there to correct me and give me insight when I get it wrong.
Amen.
Huh? And what I usually do is I give you enough verses of scripture on the same subject that it's almost impossible to get it wrong.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
I just do. I just like stay right with the word of God. I just give you a bunch of verses of scripture. It's a majority of it is going to be right.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, I'm just going to sit back and I'm going to sort through it. I'm going to eat the fish and throw away the bones. You know what? That's a lot of wiggle room for the devil. While you sit there spitting the bones, you're probably spitting the best part of the meat. You know what I'm saying? You're just going to have to trust. You're just going to have to say, look here, I'm here to be trained. I want to grab a hold of this. I want to be filled with the Word of God. I want to be filled with every good thing of the Spirit of God. I want to get these principles down. Because you can never teach the born-again experience, the new creation, the power of moving and flowing and functioning in the Holy Ghost until you live it. You can never really teach it until you live it. And it becomes an excitement to you and a joy to you. Wow, I found the place of the overcomer. Wow, it's a great adventure. I've stepped into the place of the overcomer. I found out how to overcome sin. Wow! I found the place of what it really means to be more than a conqueror. I found the place of where I can turn myself over to God, and it's God doing it, not me. And I'm just following along with his leadership, and he does it so perfectly. I'm just under a divine inspiration all day long to serve God and to fear him and obey him. It's a wonderful thing when I don't have to go with post-it notes all day. Try to remember tying strings on my fingers. Writing letters to myself, emails. I live under the Kotoshiana Makaya Tabusanama Prepitaya. Malanda Redeveya. I live under such a compulsion of the Holy Ghost that when I see people, I see a soul that's gonna spend somewhere and for eternity. And many of them, I look in their eyes and I see that they're bound by hell. And they're going to spend an eternity in a place called the lake of fire. And there's so much compassion on the inside of me welling up that I'm saying, oh God, Father, show me what to do. And the Holy Spirit sweeps me away and starts speaking through my mouth before I even knew what to say. Hallelujah. Come on, man. I'm talking about the fun life. And where does it start? Where does all this become developed? It becomes developed where you understand how to submit yourself to those who have the rule over you, where you learn to participate with divine order. This whole process that shows you how to walk in lowliness and meekness, where you learn how to serve Christ Jesus, serve His church, serve those that are around you. Because within it is a place where everything that would try to run the blockade of in the realms of pride of life and stubbornness and rebellion and self-centeredness and self-willed is broken down. It's said no to. You say no to it. If there's anything that we're going to have to understand, is it would be to grab a hold of Jesus' message, come and learn of me, Matthew chapter 11, 21. Forgive me, 28, 29. Bible reference. When I'm uncertain about a verse of scripture, I'll come and I'll stand over here. Hallelujah. Why? Because she's always in the Word. She's always studying the Word. She just knows the Word. Huh? I know the verse of scripture, but she knows the reference. Hallelujah. What a team, huh? Praise the Konami. Huh? Are any of you tired of the way you're living? Just what Jesus said. Huh? This is a free-flowing translation. Yes. Any of you tired of the way you're living?
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Come unto me.
Yes.
That's what Jesus says. Anybody who's weary and heavy laden? Huh? Yeah. So be my not known that, well, am I weary or heavy laden? I'm not sure. Are you anybody tired of the way that you're living? Yeah. Come unto me.
Yes.
And I shall give you rest.
Yes.
Huh? Huh? Take my servitude and learn of me. It's a learning process. I'm going to be taught of God, the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
What am I going to learn? Meekness and lowliness.
Yeah.
What is that all about? Jesus says, the greatest of the kingdom of God is servant of all. He said, I want to show you how the anointing works. Take towel and basin in hand. I'm going to wash your feet. I'm going to serve you. I'm here. I didn't come to be served. I came to serve. This is what Jesus said. I know that King James tried to hide, you know, make that more than what the Greek language says, and said, he translated it, I've not come to be ministered unto, but to minister. Sounds like I've not come for someone to preach to me, but I've come to preach. That's not what it said. I've not come to be served. Huh? I've come to serve and to lay my life down. See, by context, it's defined what the words mean anyways, you know. But still, all plainness of speech is important. Well, are you willing to learn it? We've got to be willing to learn this. And where do we really learn how to do this? When it's coming flying, when Scott's saying something that's not really fit into your schedule. But neither do we want people dragging in here going, oh, he called us to kind of pray. Because that ain't going to do anything. Huh? We want you to be joyful about it all. This is what Father tells us to do. This is what He wants us to do, and we want to be with Him. I'm staying with Him.
Yeah.
You know, I guess, how can I say this? It is so easy for me to be merciful to people and to forgive people and to pray earnestly for people because I'm so desperate for God to take care of me. I'm so desperate to be right with Him. I'm so needy. I am so in need of His love and mercy and help that it's no problem for me to see somebody do something stupid and persecute me or do something stupid and say all manner of evil against me or do crazy, silly things against the church and me have a hard time forgiving them and praying for them. I have no problem with it because I am just as much in need. I'm in need. I've left the arrogant life. I left the pride thing. All about me and all my offenses. And I've learned enough about servitude to to recognize how needy and how dependent upon the Lord that I am. So therefore, it's so easy for me to understand people being stupid. It's so easy for me to understand people doing things wrong and then having a response that prays for them because I need prayer. Because I need mercy, because I need God's help. And I know what he's going to do when he sees me do these things, but that is not my motivator. My motivator is just, I'm so in need of his help. I'm so in need and so dependent upon God to get this thing right. I don't want to die and go to hell. Amen. I want to make heaven. Yes. And I know the severity and the terror of the Lord. Yeah. And Father's not changing things around to suit me. That's arrogance. It's just arrogance. To somehow, oh, I know I'm not doing everything that God wants me to do, but I have a better opinion of God than that. What? That is so blinded by the pride of life. That is so influenced by demon spirits called humanism, trying to make your wrong right. Huh? Anybody can sit around and argue and put their spin on it. You can justify throwing hot water, boiling hot water in somebody's face. You can. There's ways to do it. There's a place of such nihilistic, thinking that there's no such thing as wrong. That there's a way to justify everything. And that God's word is very clear about what he's called us to do. Let me quickly just turn to another verse of scripture for you in Hebrews chapter 4. Now, this is fresh bread, basically. Because I got this, the way that I'm delivering this to you, I got this in prayer. Now, if you come to prayer, you'll get something too. I'm going to tell you, listen, everything that God has ever done in my life has been at the juncture of prayer. Everything, every area, every way that God has ever used me has been at the juncture of persistent, faithful, passionate prayer. Everything. So much so, we used to hear all the time, in ministry, you don't hear as much as you used to hear it. Little faith, little power. Little prayer, little faith. Really, little prayer, little power. And where people just really know how to sow into things of the Spirit, to recognize that there's that place of conversation and talking with God and earnestness about him and being willing to walk through whatever it is that's hindering you and making it to where it's not inspirational, making it where you don't want to be doing it anyways. It's just all the stuff that's standing between you and him. It's just all the stuff. Because you get through that, you're gonna enjoy his presence. There's a manifest presence. Ooh. Anywhere you're at, at any time you lift your hand towards heaven. Hallelujah. If I could get you to go to a place of meeting with God every day, I'm gonna tell you right now, if I could get you involved in the kingdom, you have to ask yourself, what are you doing in ministry in the kingdom? Right now, you have to ask yourself. And somebody says, well, I don't feel all condemned and bad about myself. Go ahead and give it a go. Amen. Hallelujah. Go ahead and feel bad about yourself for a few minutes in a right kind of way. But what are you doing in the kingdom? Where are you at in ministry? Because everybody's supposed to be doing things in the kingdom and doing things in ministry. Huh? And amen, the rusty barrel is where it all begins. Building up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God, because you're never going to walk in brotherly love or humility or lowliness or anything else without the Holy Ghost. You're going to have just false humility, false lowliness. You're going to have servitude without any heart in doing it. You're just going to have the mully grubs while you're doing it, huh? You're just dragging your feet the whole time. I can't believe they're expecting me of this. I know that this isn't really what God meant when he said it in his word. And that's just because you can't do anything. You can't do any of this. You can't do anything without him. Can't do any of this without him. He's made us able ministers of the gospel by the Spirit. Hallelujah. In the life that we live, in the way that we minister, the way that we preach, the way that we conduct ourselves, every part of our conversation, it all comes out of the realm of heaven. Hallelujah. How about Satana Yakeshte? Now you're going to have to break through the barriers. When you go to prayer and you're feeling, I don't feel inspired, that's your stuff. That's your problem. That's your hindrances. oh, I just can't commit, keep the commitment. I try to commit and it worked for 3 days. And then as soon as you come to your senses and recognize that you have failed in your commitment, pick yourself up and start again. Don't just lay there. 2 years later, what happened? Well, I went for 3 days and I failed, so I've just been laying here ever since. You've been laying there for 2 years? You're not moving? See, submission is far higher, greater realm. That submission is a far greater and better realm. Hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, some of you need to practice this a little bit more. You're just too quiet. There's some times you need to be quiet. There's other times you need to say, oh, God, forgive me. Oh, God, I'm going to get this. Oh, Pastor, thanks for being so merciful. I can't believe how patient you've been with me. You are amazing that you're still putting up with me after all this time. I've seen God more than anything else in my life just watching how long-suffering you are with me. Instead of having it the other way around. Hello. Because the pride of life is a fortifiable force. And stubbornness and rebellion has been taught to you from birth. And the thing's got to be broken. And it was broken entirely by the new birth, but you're not willing to be obedient. You're not willing to deny yourself. You're not willing to forsake the former conversation that you had when you were blinded, ignorant, without God. In Jesus' name. A right and an obedient spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen. In Jesus' name. So are you over there with me in Hebrews 4? Hallelujah. Ketota moshikata hapa. Hato shikidi be preteya. Somebody said, well, why can't we just have Holy Ghost meetings every night? Did you know we can do Holy Ghost meetings every night. All of you be just laying out on the floor, laughing, rolling around, running, jumping. Whoa, praise God. And that's all good. And especially if you went home and did that. But reality of it is somebody's going to have to be taught the good word of God. Amen. And understand that there are some things that you're going to have adjusted in your life and be willing to pay attention to if you're going to live the overcomer life. If you're going to live this life where that you're kept by the power of God and where that you walk in the anointing, where you walk in the divine nature, where you give place to the Spirit of the Lord to develop you in everything that Father has given us privilege to have now that we're a new creation. You got to have this. Somebody said, oh, I only like to minister the things where everybody's just all happy and they're just all receiving and swaying in the glory. You know what? If the Lord allows you to do that, who am I to say anything? But that's not what a pastor is supposed to do. I'm supposed to teach you the whole counsel of God and you're supposed to obey it. Amen. Hallelujah. And I'm supposed to obey it too. Husbandman has to be first partaker of the fruit. So I'm going to teach you the whole counsel of God as I walk in obedience to the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whose fruit you can behold and the end of faith you can see it so you can follow. Amen. And you're supposed to obey and imitate and do it and say, yeah, we're together in this thing. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sebom retaya. Huh? Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God is good. Shoo! Manda prataya. I know some of you are still on that 60% thing. Am I one of the 18? Or just get on over in here. Come on, man. Let's just be an exception. Let's be, 96%. Just leave two of you out. Now guess about who two are, the two of you are. Now, just everybody get in, 100% response. Amen. I'm not going to be no statistic in the house. It's not going to be a statistic in the house. But it is sobering to consider it, because it really is what it goes, is how it goes down. I've talked to so many ministers. I've been with so many preachers over my entire life. I've listened to the story over and over again. I've watched it. I've seen how it works. Unfortunately, those are the statistics. I'm sorry about it. I don't want anybody to believe that about themselves. I want everybody to get over here and start acting like Jesus, starting now. And it's the Word of God and the Spirit of God that shows us how to act like Jesus. Praise God. Because He is the living Word who showed us the fullness of the written Word. Because He said, behold, I've come in the volume of the book to do your will. Doing the Word of God is doing the will of God. It's signed, sealed, and delivered. It's settled forever. There is no option. You're not doing the Word of God, you're not doing the will of God. Period. Hallelujah. Sopran. You cannot live for yourself any more than a king or a queen or a prince could live for themselves. They had to live for their kingdom. Had no right to marry who they wanted to marry. They had to marry who it was assigned within the framework of what would benefit the kingdom. There's a huge legacy of that. There's story after story over 3,000 years of stories about where people who had stepped in such a place of responsibility, they belonged to the state. You and I belong to the kingdom.
Amen.
What's your problem? She just wanted to be with her mom. Is that it? Anna? No. Papa's preaching. No. Right now, lift your hands towards heaven. Lift your hands right towards heaven. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, in Jesus' name, this thing goes off you. You obey Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Sukataya namaze Jesu. Ikarabasita namazahinaha. Baakia namasipa. Biarabafatiya pete. Biarafasitu lamosutikeshe. Miadaya namosikistene. Marana susus. Ebreve susina. In the name of Jesus. So I said, what's that all about? I'm dealing with a spiritual thing.
True. Amen.
And I'm going to tell you right now, some children can be extremely self-willed. And then you try to deal with that completely after the arm of discipline, and it ain't going to work out good for you.
True.
You have to deal with the dimension of it in the realms of the Spirit. We all have to, earlier in life we do this, we all have to learn how to say to God, Father, I'm doing it your way. And many times that's going to hurt. That's going to be challenging. It's going to be hard. And I think that somehow people miss that. They think, well, everything that I'm going to do for the Lord is going to be easy. I'm just going to want to do it. I'm going to be so excited about doing it. And that really isn't what it goes down to, because the Lord didn't describe it as, you know, fun and excitement. He just say, I got a great fun and exciting thing for you guys to do. This is the greatest fun on the planet. Deny yourself. He said, take up your cross. He said, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. He likened it to denying ourselves, dying on a cross.
Yeah.
Taking a cross. Amen. To say, I'm not living for myself. I don't live for the state. I mean, I'm not on the level of just living for the state or living for in that dimension. You and I, we live for the kingdom of God. We are His ambassadors. We're the people who show that He lives, that He is alive right now, that He's reproduced Himself, His life in us, that He has conquered sin and hell and death and the grave. Hallelujah. 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 Brita fatokaneya. The most important thing that I want to get across to you tonight is that the enemy of your soul is seeking to destroy you, to put all that he can put on you, to lie to you, to curse you, to deceive you. And there is only one place of safety. And you're going to have to learn that you can't go mixing it up with the world around you and just picking and choosing what you want to do and think that you're going to live protected from the one who wants to destroy your soul in hell. I'm telling you, demon spirits are much more powerful than you've given them any credit for. Satan is much more powerful than you're willing to acknowledge. And there is only one place of safety. It is in Christ Jesus.
Yeah,
he's saying he doesn't even have a chance. He doesn't have a chance. If you and I are willing to do what Father says, we're kept by the power of God. But we have to be willing to participate. We have to be willing to obey. We have to be willing to cooperate with Him. We have to be willing to live and dwell in Him. Hallelujah. And it shouldn't be like this concept, you know, it's like, oh, we got to, you know, run over to live in the Lord just so that we don't die. I mean, it should be, let's go live in Him because this is the abundant life. We get the God kind of life. But I mean, we got to get it. I've got to try to get you from every side here. In Jesus' name. Amen. Just keep at it. Just pray. Just pick her up and pray more with her. Walk around with her praying. You know, that's what, and this is for every parent in this place. There's more that you're going to get done picking your children up, walking around praying in the Holy Ghost with them for an hour of prayer than you're ever going to get done putting them in the hot seat, sending them to the cold room or whatever it is. Time out. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And what I was trying to say over here a little bit ago is that submission is a far higher realm than discipline. Lord Jesus. Submission is a much higher realm than discipline. But when you are submitted to the Holy Ghost, not just disciplined in the Holy Ghost, you hear what I'm saying? But you're submitted to the Holy Ghost, it's going to work out as it were a discipline. In some respects, I hate to use that word, but I fail to have another word to describe consistency. Because it's definitely not a discipline for me to interact with someone that I love. Huh? And the way that we're supposed to be interacting with the Lord Jesus is as His bride. I just so want you to grab that. I want you to get drunk on that. I want you to get overwhelmed with the presence of the Lord. I really wouldn't give her what she wants. I really wouldn't give her what she wants. Not after what we've been through for the past 30 minutes. Huh? Yeah, so just leave her in the discipline zone. Otherwise, we've just sacrificed 30 minutes of our life for nothing. Jesus. Wisdom. It takes wisdom to raise kids. Amen.
Amen.
It's just that I had to be involved in that process, so I want a little bit of reward. a little thought of some fruit. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. Jesus. There's good things about being a grandparent, and there's bad things about being a grandparent. The bad thing is like going, I would never let that happen. There's just no way. The good thing is they're wonderful. We love them. Praise God for them. I got to build myself up here a little bit. Hallelujah. We can all intercede together here. Hallelujah. Jesus. Hallelujah. I don't believe anybody grows out of bad behavior. I don't believe it. You do not grow out of bad behavior.
True.
You just grow up with it. It's some place that's got to be stopped.
Amen.
Praise God for parents who know how to look at bad behavior, deal with it, not allow it, do whatever it takes to bring it to an end. Because I'm going to tell you right now, that's really putting everybody that much more of a step forward in terms of learning how to obey Heavenly Father and learning how to obey the Holy Spirit and do what He says to do. And really so much of what the church and ministry is really about, it's spiritual parenting. And you've got to be willing to be spiritually parented. Of course, you've got to also know that you're loved. You've got to be able to deal with those things and say, I'm not loved, I'm this outcast child, I was adopted. All those lies. Because the enemy does throw that thing at you.
True.
And because it becomes a fight. You know, you're not willing to obey, right?
Yeah.
And thus you're getting, the downcast look, right? And so now it builds a credibility that you're not liked, right? Hmm?
Yeah.
So by the help and the grace of God, we're going to show you a whole lot of love.
Yes.
We're going to show you more love than we've ever shown you before. We're going to show you more kindness than we've ever shown you before. I mean, if whatever it's going to take. But we're going to also show you more strict discipline with it.
Amen.
Huh? More strict, when I say that, just saying of responsibility. You need to be in the Word.
Yes.
I mean, we're going to tell you to go. I'm not going to tell you to come to my house and mow my lawn and change my light bulbs. Right? That ain't about serving me. I'm not going to tell you to go out there and wash my car and make sure you get those rims good. Because people have reduced serving in the church to that. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to say that. You know, if there are things weren't being taken care of in the church, I'd step in and do it. I praise God for so many people that serve in the church and you take care of things in the church. It is a terrible, lowly assignment to clean the bathrooms, and especially the guys' bathroom. Bless the heart of every person who's taken up that responsibility. Someone said to me the other day, they texted me or emailed me and said, should I go back to cleaning the men's bathroom? And I didn't respond to that. I did not respond to that because I'm not going to tell anybody to do that. You're going to have to be called of the Lord. What I'm saying, that's a tough job. What I am going to demand of you is to do the things that Father has required of us, because it is a matter of life or death to you. It's a matter of whether or not you're going to be able to enjoy what you've come to be a part of here, what you've signed up to be a part of. You're going to have to get into the Word. You're going to have to study the Word of God. You're going to have to come to the place where you love the good Word of God. You love it. You love it. You love it. In Jesus' name, you love it. You enjoy it. Enjoy being in the Word. Hallelujah. It's hard to break away. You enjoy praying in the Holy Ghost. It's so refreshing. Hey, it's like something you just do all day long throughout the day. And I know that many of you, that's really happening in your life. That's exciting. How many of you, that's happening in your life? Just enjoy praying in the Holy Ghost all throughout the day. Good. Hallelujah. Because why? Because you've given yourself enough to submitting to the Holy Ghost to where that he just, as it were, almost just takes over. And he just gives you, you've given place to that inspiration enough to where that inspiration just continually there, bubbling up, overflowing. Hallelujah. Huh? And then you come to a place where you don't allow yourself to go too long, and you say, wait a minute, just stop everything. It's time to have a get filled moment. Right? Hallelujah. Time to have a get filled moment. For me, because I get to, my job assignment is to give myself to the Word in prayer, I constantly have inspiration. Because being in the Word, I'm just or ministering people on the phone, just constantly, I'm getting filled up. That's the way I get filled. And out of that comes, hymns, psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. We want you to come to church and learn how to get filled in church. To where you're not just singing the song that's being sung, but you got a spiritual, you can get over into psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Where you just get down and muster and yanda la bashika and yanda la basebre bebebebeka. Instead of standing there. Because I said, now, sing in the Spirit. Okay. The responsive thing of trying to be obedient, because that's wrong too. Praise God that you're willing to be obedient and participate, but that's wrong. You should be, huh? There's got to be some inspiration going on with this thing. I'm like beckoning you to come into a realm. I'm not beckoning you to do a deed. I'm beckoning you to come into a realm, to do something by the Spirit of the Lord, to cooperate with God. And here's the principles by which you now cooperate with God. So it's a different kind of obedience. It's a different kind of submission. It's like there's no models for it around you in an earthly realm. It's like understanding meekness and being bold at the same time. There's no model for that. There's being prideful and arrogant and being bold. But being meek and bold, to be humble and confident, that's purely anointing, Holy Ghost anointing. Hallelujah. Hambre de sequita. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for helping these babies. Now, I want you to look with me in verse 12 and verse 13. And I want you to understand that what the Word of God does when you come into this place, the Word of God tries you. It comes at you. It confronts you. Huh? It confronts you. The Word of God confronts you. The Word of God will inspire you. The Word of God will cause you to joy and rejoice. The entrance of His Word will give you revelation. Huh? Hallelujah. But the Word of God will also confront you. Because if you've got things going on in your life that is wrong or that is not in cooperation with what Father wants, it is just slamming right at you. It's coming at you. It's intense. It's a sword. I went to church tonight and got sliced. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to read that to you. For the Word of God is living. It is powerful. Hallelujah. How many of you want the Word of God to be living and powerful? Amen. To where you can speak the Word of life, and especially to sickness and disease. Woo! My. And they got to be healed right there on the spot. Well, it's got to be too powerful to you to demand such change, to demand spiritual change, to demand conduct and behavioral change. Hallelujah. You can't be your own man. You can't live your own life. You can't live isolated from the church and be right with God. You cannot. Because you go out from among us that you may be made manifest, that you not of us. Now I'm talking to somebody on the web. I saw a little cartoon yesterday. We were just laughing about it. And everybody's showing up at the gates, you know, and Peter's standing there and goes, okay, guys, I got some good news and some bad news for some of you. All of you that were in church, come on in. You're right, come on in. All of you that watched church on the web, you get to watch heaven on the web. And said, you need to send that everywhere. Everybody needs to get it. And it's true. It's true. You can't be disconnected from the church and think that you're a part of the kingdom of God. You can't be your own man and say you're God's man. Amen. And I didn't work that way. True. You can't say that you're part of the universal global church. Yeah. And you just kind of bounce around. You float around like a cloud. From one place to the next, wherever the wind may blow you. Because the Lord describes that as someone different. Yeah. Clouds without water. Driven of the Father has called us to come and take our place as members in particular to cooperate with something that is so huge. The very manifestation of the person of Jesus Christ. The very manifestation that the church is the fullness of Him that filleth all things. And that we're built up together around as living stones around the cornerstone to be now built as a holy habitation by the Holy Ghost to offer up praise that is acceptable to the Father by Jesus Christ. That is absolutely a consecration and a surrender to something that is so important and essential and so much bigger than anything that any individual is. It takes everything that you are to participate with in a complete and total surrender where you bound, hand and foot tied to the horns of the altar to be offered up in smoke. Lord, what do you want to do with my life? Turn you into smoke. A living sacrifice, an offering on the altar. Hallelujah. Where you're just living out something that is about interaction. Huh. So you're living out as a very expression of communion between God and man. That's what the altar is all about. The privilege of access and fellowship. Jesus' name. All the things that would try to stand between you and this heavenly vision. And this wonderful work of grace that is taking place in your life when you are made a new creation, when you are changed by the power of God and brought into this place to be a part of the kingdom of God under the authority of the Holy Spirit, to be taught of God, to live out the very life of God. Oh, what a privilege. Oh, my. We should want to jump in head first. Oh, I mean, whatever it takes, whatever I must do, whatever. Father, there's nothing too great that you could ask of me. I'll go anywhere you want me to go. I'll be whatever you want me to be. I'll do whatever you want me to do. Yeah. Huh. Oh, just the privilege of being here, part of you. I want to fully live for you. I don't want to live for myself. I hate my life in this world because I discovered something so beautiful. Because other way around, it's just legalism and it's just,
yeah.
Your heart's not in it. There's no inspiration. Oh, I got to hate my life in this world so that I can, you know, love the life of God. No, I ain't going to do nothing. But I see this wonderful life in Him. And this is all the life I want. And that's what caused me to go to prayer. That and enough wisdom to recognize, wait a minute, if I'm going to develop in the things of the Spirit, I've got to give myself to spiritual things. And that there is nothing that more profoundly develops me spiritually that calls me mature and to grow as learning how to pray by the Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. To learn how to have a conversation, to learn how to live out the dynamics of this kind of relationship. Hallelujah. Relationship is found and birthed in the Holy Ghost and developed and matured in the Holy Ghost in doing what the Holy Ghost is doing. And there's nothing that highlights what God the Holy Ghost is doing like prayer. Where there we receive then to now be able to move in those things that He gives us to do to reach the lost and to touch people's lives. That's why Paul's saying, getting everybody, recruiting everybody, pray for me that a door of utterance may be opened unto me, that I may make known the gospel as I ought to. I know, I understand that the very foundation of it is prayer. He tells us to continually offer prayer and supplication and intercessions for all men. And begin to really understand what the value of this with all prayer and supplication or pleading, urgent pleadings in the Holy Ghost and watching thereunto with thanksgiving. You've got to learn how to do that. It's got to become a priority. I'm going to tell you right now, I didn't come to get to church early for prayer for your sake. I did it for me. I did it for my sake. Because I want those things that are going to be for His sake. And I know what God is going to do when prayer is present. And I know that more than likely, there's not a lot that He's going to do when it's absent. Every juncture of my life has been a result of simply obeying God and doing those things that He said to do when He said to do them. And when there is a call to prayer or when there is a call to anything, you want to respond to that. Hear me. I praise God for what's going on in your lives and different dimensions of what's going on in the church. But listen, let's go with everything that Father's given us an opportunity to do. The Word of God's living. It's powerful. And it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces. It will pierce you. It pierces and cuts. It pierces you. It pierces to the piercing and dividing. That's cutting, splitting in half, soul and spirit. It is a discerner of the thoughts. Forgive me, and of the bone and the marrow, joint and marrow, and is a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart. Listen to this. I want you to hear this. Neither is there anything, any creature, any person, anything going on in your life that is not manifested when the word is going forth. The word of God is like a floodlight from heaven that shines. And based upon how people respond to the word of God, you listen to me. Based upon how people so respond to the word of God is a revelation of where they're at with God. It's where they're at spiritually with the things of heaven. Because it's just a big, gigantic searchlight. And there's nothing hidden. The word, I mean, I tell people all the time. They say, well, you know, I'm thinking about this relationship or that relationship in the name of Jesus. I'm thinking about this thing or that thing, this relationship. Say, bring them to church. Or I'm thinking about getting involved in, somebody said, I'm thinking about getting involved in a business with so-and-so, but they don't go to this church. Bring them to church. Just let's see how much they start squirming in the meeting. Listen to how much they don't agree with at the end of the meeting. It's a searchlight. It's the word of God's going out. Hear about how they don't like anybody correcting anybody. It's a searchlight. The word of God, it makes manifest everything. The light. It's the light of God. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. It reveals everything. And you and I are naked before Him. Look at this verse of Scripture. It says, but right here in verse 13, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in His sight, but all things are naked. There's nothing hidden. When? The Word of God's being declared by the Spirit of the Lord. And opened unto the eyes of Him with whom we have to do. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So we say, search me, Lord. Then he starts doing it. And he comes, he tries us with his word. The Lord says that we've corrected our children for our own profit. But as a father, he corrects us. For our profit. And then his word is going forth right now. And he's trying his best to bring you out of a problem situation. He's trying to get you out of the things that you're doing that have nothing to do with what he's doing. If he can bring you into agreement with himself, which he labors to do. First and foremost, you get to receive all the things that he has for you there. That's the place. Secondly, which is just about as valuable, is that he protects you against the decisions that you're making out there that are all ultimately going to end in your own destruction. To some level, it's going to end in some kind of a problem. It's not hard to walk with God and live a life free from sin. To live a life in obedience, full of the Holy Ghost, having days of heaven upon earth. All it's going to cost you is obedience. I want you to stand with me. Thank you, Father. Yisebe risato kushi pala la mano sakita mararaste prefete. Yeste kiri dana maso patarene ki peste vita la man. I really, honestly, I feel like having an altar call. In some respects, it's really just an altar call about being willing to be obedient to God. And understanding that there are definite rallying points of that obedience. that all the obedience that you sow into on a daily basis, and hopefully you sow into everything that you know in God, because you're, first of all, the Holy Ghost is constantly bringing these things to your remembrance. And so when you're persecuted, you bless. Could you just live out the life of the Spirit? Because he's just going to do that. And you deal with temptation. Temptation comes at you, and you're living by the Word and doing the will of the Father. And so you're so full of the Holy Ghost, now you can submit yourself to God, and Satan flees, and you don't just give yourself into that demonic thing. Because you do, and Satan's got more power over your life. And we got to shut that down. I just want to read this verse of scripture to you. I started to quote it, because I'm dealing with a bunch of different stuff in here, and so I just understanding how to get around it, come in the back door. Father creeps up behind you sometimes and gets you when you're not thinking, surprise you. Thank you, Jesus. See, it is a great benefit can you guys take care of it? There's three people back there. Could you just, it's just like a volume, just turn it down a little bit. It's a great benefit when you know where you're going. Okay, you're not just wandering around like going, I really don't know where we're going. I just don't really know what we're doing. He says turn right, so let's just turn right. Okay, now what are we going to do? Okay, we're going to go left. Okay, go left. And it says we've got to walk about a mile, then we get to rest. Whew. You know what I'm saying? That's very frustrating. You can turn it up a little bit now. It's very frustrating, right? But when you know where you're going, when you know, you see a big picture that Father wants to pour out his glory in an unprecedented way right now at this time point, and that we're at a very critical time point spiritually with this nation. We're at a very critical time point with respect to where we are relative to the end of the world. We're at a very critical time point with your family and with your friends and with people around you that you're responsible for, because I'm going to tell you right now, there's not a single person that you run into that you're not responsible for God, for their soul. And somehow you're going to have to understand that your influence and who you are as a person isn't going to make any difference. But who you will allow Christ Jesus to be through you, when you allow the manifest presence of God to grow and mature in your life, it is going to change the whole dynamics of things. If you see that where we're going is a place to where that the Holy Spirit has free, reign. He has his complete liberty and control over our life, and you're wanting to come to that place with him, then it's very easy to understand the rights and the lefts and the turns and why we're going here and why we need to do this and why we need to participate in these things, this call to an assembly before his presence. Disobedience is so intense to Father. He says, it is so defiling. He said, if you have a son or a daughter and they're rebellious and they will not listen, then you stone them. And you be the first one to stone them, that you may crush rebellion out of the heart of Israel. Because it's going to turn the heart of the people away from ever being what I've called them to be, which really, when it comes down to it, it's the only means by which men are ever going to be saved. God have a witness in the earth. And so I understand the one who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, how he feels about obedience and how he feels about our cooperation, how he feels about our submission to his word, how he's going to try us in these areas, how he's going to take the leader and lead him right to the bitter water, and watch all of the murmuring, complaining, accusation go down, because now we're all thirsty and you've got us over here with bitter water. I pray tonight that you'll let the Holy Spirit show you things that you do not have the mental capability of ever understanding. I don't care what your IQ is. You do not have the ability mentally to understand what's being said. You've got to be willing to respond to the Holy Ghost on the levels of certain things that you do understand. And he says, I want you to, for example, I want you to get down on your knees and pray. Well, I can understand that. I'm glad the Lord doesn't ask me to get down on my knees in prayer because I hate being on my knees. But I want you to come over here and I want you to pray. I can understand that. And so as I do what he's told me to do, then I begin to comprehend these things that go beyond my ability to understand because he shows me them. He makes them real to me by the Holy Ghost. The Lord tells us if we give all diligence to making our call and election sure, then we will not be unfruitful and barren. People have got to come to a place where that they're not willing to continue on being unfruitful and barren. I mean, Hannah brought a great revival into Israel. She birthed a great gifting and provision and breakthrough for Israel because she was not willing to be unfruitful and barren any longer. She was willing to do whatever it takes. Okay, you need to take care of that child right now. Okay, seeing as you do not understand, that means you need to go outside with the child if you do not have ability to quiet the child down. I shouldn't have to tell anybody that. Right? Everybody should have enough discernment and sensitivity to say, where are we at in this meeting? What's going on? What is God trying to do? Let me do what is right to do that is respectful to the things of the Spirit of the Lord and to the church and quit making it about myself and what's convenient for me. Are you with me?
Yes.
And say, well, I can't help it. I can't control my child. Yeah, you can help it and you can control your child simply by going in, out of the room. Are you listening to me? So this is on every level. People, we're going to have to know how to behave ourselves in the house of God. We're going to have to know where our responsibility is at. Once again, where is it that we're serving in the ministry? What is it that we're doing in the kingdom of God? And maybe tonight you can't even answer that. You can't say, well, I don't know that I'm really doing anything in the kingdom of God. Well, you know what that ought to do for you? That ought to drive you to a place of prayer.
Yeah.
That ought to drive you to a place of seeking God to say, Lord, I'm not willing to just be content with saying, shrugging my shoulders and saying, I don't know.
Yes.
Yeah,
because you'll spend the rest of your life shrugging your shoulders and saying, I don't know. Because if you're willing to live without these things, you're going to be without them. God is only going to use people and gift these things to people. I mean, it's gifts that cannot live without them. Because they're so sacred that if you can live without them, you'll abuse them if you have them. And they'll be your death and ruin. They've got to be so precious to you and so sacred to you that you'll give your whole life for it to have them. They're more valuable to you than life itself. His will, His loving kindness, His tender mercies, that which He has given to us as a free gift is more valuable to you than any single thing. Music's not about you singing your song or me singing my song or you singing your song. It's about worshiping God. Don't step on my toes and get in my song. That's such an arrogance. Yet it rules the church. People doing their own stuff. Stars in their own mind. It's, understand me, I'm trying to tell you about a spiritual wickedness that is at play in the world around us. That is very effective at touching everybody's life, including you and me. And there's only one place of safety from it. It's His Word, His Spirit. It's obeying God. It's running into that realms of His divine glory and saying, okay, Father, I'm going to do it your way. Otherwise, I'm going to be taken out. Otherwise, I'm going to be influenced with unholy things. Otherwise, I'm going to find myself going from one failure to the next failure. Instead of going from glory to glory, I'm going from shame to shame. Got to get off the roller coaster, people, because that is not an indication of the right fruit. Like I say, you need to get in the rocket and blast towards heaven. Hallelujah. And it really, I'm trying to help you understand some things that maybe it really has to be for you to some degree of discipline, because you consecrate yourself and say, I've got to change. I can't continue to go on like this. And so whatever it takes, I'm going to put those things into place until I get the breakthrough of the relationship kind of interaction that is supposed to be there, and doing it out of inspiration. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And doing it out of desperation, because I got to be used by God. I'm not living my life as a mere human being. I'm not living my life like this. Hallelujah. Come on, girl. And you won't. Not with that. Not with that response. You won't. You just won't. See, it's really all. I've watched again, over and again, I've seen who will make it. I watched who's going to step into the anointing and be used by God. It has to do with your response to His word. In a meeting just like this, of whether you just look to yourself and become all condemned and overwhelmed, or whether you look to God and get real hungry and passionate and say, oh, I see, Lord. I see, Father, that this is what needs to happen in my life. And I want it. Here in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 9, it says, furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which have corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Well, I hope. Is there anybody in here tonight, you don't give your parents reverence when they correct you? You act stubborn and rebellious and all snotty? It's just demonic. That's just demonic. It is the behavior and nature of a demon spirit to behave that way. You can say, well, you know, this is... It's demonic. It is a demonic realm. And it ain't going to get you anywhere but trouble. And it's not going to be about a spanking from your parents. It's going to be about a spanking from life. It's about you finding out that your hard head isn't hard enough to deal with what's coming at you, because it's going to break you. We watch it happen all the time. People just get busted by life. They could have saved themselves from that. They didn't have to go through all that stuff. So I'm going to stay for a minute on this. If there's anybody in here, you're not respecting and reverencing your parents, let's get that straight right now. They don't even know what that means. But they've got to learn at the level that they can understand. Right? Naomi doesn't know anything about what it means to respect her parents. She's just screaming and hollering because she wants to do something. Huh? So there's a certain amount of level of responsibility there based upon what they know. There's a certain amount of level of responsibility based upon what you know. God wants to show you a whole lot more. Would you like to see more?
Yes.
Then you're going to have to receive more.
Yes.
And to be part of the receive more family, you're going to have to obey. Obey God. I had some people come to me one time and say, you know, we really like the anointing in the house, but we don't like it with you, you know, sorting everybody out and hollering and screaming. And I said to them, well, you know what? The anointing's in the house because I sort everybody out and holler and scream. So go try to find the anointing somewhere else. See how it works out. But once again, I'm not pursuing my own will. Once again, I've got a heavenly vision that isn't something that is just given to me in a dream somewhere. I've got a heavenly vision that everybody can sit down and read and understand very clearly. This is what Father's will. And so I'm not calling us to do something fringe, something unique. You say, God's got a glorious church that He wants revealed in the earth. God wants His church as the fullness of Him that filleth all things to be revealed in the earth. Father has given us an anointing and an authority to be so effective that goes way beyond what we've been willing to do. And people come walking in here, waltzing in here with all their trash and issues and saying that they're walking with God. Give me a break. Get right with God. Get full of the Holy Ghost. Start doing it God's way. I mean, there have been too many times in my life I've looked at people who just had a little bit of yieldedness. I said, get full of the Holy Ghost right now. And they immediately were filled with the Holy Ghost. All I did was just look at them, just a little bit angry, a little bit harsh. Get filled with the Holy Ghost right now. But when there's any kind of arrogance or defiance, nothing's going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. You're going to have to be converted, become like a little child. Turn me up. You're going to have to be converted and become like a little child. You're going to have to be converted and become like a little child. You're going to have to be converted and become like a little child. I know you're a grown adult. Well, what's that done for you? You have to be converted and become like a little child. We've had fathers after the flesh from which we received correction and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? I never want Father for one moment to think that I'm disrespecting Him. I never one moment want to be arrogant towards the Father, stubborn towards Him. Jesus. For they verily for a few days chastened us for their own profit so that they could be proud of us. But He's corrected us for our own profit. For our own benefit. Because we never can receive the light when we're in the darkness. We're never going to receive the truth of believing a lie. We're going to never learn how to move with the Holy Ghost when we're constantly mixing it with something else. But He's chastened us that we may be made partakers of His holiness. Oh God, help Your people in Your mercy to hear, I pray, Father. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have to quit being so impressed by the world, by demon spirits around you, by evil men, before you can ever understand these things. As long as you're impressed by the world, all of this makes no sense at all. It has no value, no meaning. But I hear my Father talking to me. And I hear Father talking to this church. And I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to obey God. We're going to follow after Him. We're going to understand that every correction and every instruction is about being made partakers of His holiness. And if we're not being partakers of His holiness, then there's something going on with the way that we're dealing with instruction and correction. We're going to walk over here and we're going to be lights into a world. We're going to be the light unto the world. We're going to be salt of the earth. We're going to be the means by which God advances His program in the earth. We're not gonna live our day in, day out for ourselves. We live for Him. You have sat and been partakers of listening to the Word of God in such a way that it's not even hardly taught in most places in the world. And when it's taught, people that are hungry for God are just overwhelmed by it. To hear about the freedom of a new creation, of a new creature, someone now who's liberated to live out the heavenly life and walk in the fullness of God, and people hear that and then go ahead and think that the world is somehow better, and they're impressed with demon spirits and demonic things and forces of hell. You've never seen, your eyes have never been opened. Tonight, let God touch you. Let God touch you in such a way. There's people in here. I can see it on you. The Word of God reveals things. You impress with the world. You can't go and change colors tomorrow at school and fit in. Try to just hang with the demonic people that are full of demon spirits. And want them to like you. You want the devil to like you? You want those who are demonic possessed under demonic powers to like you?
No.
I mean, think about it, people. That means that you have no understanding at all. You have no spiritual knowledge at all. You're totally blind. Totally blind. It's about time to wake up. And these things go forth tonight. We're declaring these things to you. And I'm talking to you about obeying from the oldest to the least, because you're going to have to be willing to be a part of Father's correction, Father's instruction. He says, I want you to meet me here. A young man named Evan Roberts. It's all right. These girls have got to stay in church. A young man named Evan Roberts. Jesus. Father, we thank you that you bring order into our lives. Thank you, Jesus. 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 A young man named Evan Roberts said, what do I have to do to be a part of the movings of God? He listened to a pastor describe something to him, and it was really Father speaking, and say, you meet me here and you do these things and you'll be a part. Just do this. His pastor said, just be in all the meetings. Jesus. You're just going to have to take her out, I reckon. But now everybody, the whole family's got to go. It's just not right. It's just out of order. I can't deal with it. I cannot deal with it. It's out of order. So I can't send you out because it's out of order. Your house has got to come in order. Your house needs to come into order. Because that's just out of order. Spiritual. It's just spiritual. It's not even natural. It's spiritual. You guys get it right. You're leaders in the household of God. And so you have to do it right. Father places responsibilities on you and me. If you're going to make this about people's personalities and whether or not someone's dignity is being preserved, you need to be converted, become like a little child, understand you're in the house of God and you're being corrected and taught how to do it God's way. This isn't about personalities. It's not about egos. It's not about people getting promoted to some place of great, you know, stardom and glory to where everybody thinks they're so perfect and wonderful. It's about Father and Him and Christ Jesus being revealed amidst His people. It's about us getting it right according to God's foundation of things. If we have to spend our whole life doing nothing, if all day long it's nothing but getting ready to be able to properly participate with God in the sanctuary, in the place of it called His church, then that's what we do. It's time we quit wiping our feet on Father. And if you can't feel that, then you've got a problem, because I can feel that big in my spirit. I can feel it big. And I believe that anybody who hears the Holy Ghost and who's hooked up with God feels it big inside of them. They're not offended and wondering what's going on. For you to be offended and wondering what's going on, you're so far away from what Father's heart is and what the Spirit of the Lord is unfolding and what He's demanding. God demands it. He demands men to repent. He demands men to be right. He demands it. He demands our lives to be completely hidden away. He demands it. Just demands it. If you want to hold on to your life, you're in the wrong program, and you're never going to move forward with God, holding on to your own life, preserving your own in whatever. I used to sing a song, preserving each man's dignity, upholding each man's pride. One in the Spirit, we are one in the Spirit. I thought it was the craziest humanistic song anybody could ever sing. We're not about upholding each man's pride and preserving each man's dignity. That is a false. Anybody remember that song besides me? Jesus, help us. We were singing that and then calling it revival. Let's not walk in the counsel of the ungodly anymore. Let's not stand in the way of sinners. Let's not sit in the seat of the scornful. But let's delight in the Lord. Be like a tree planted by the water. It's always producing the fruits of the Spirit. It's always producing the fruits of His life. Father is correcting us for the sole purpose that we may be partakers of His holiness. Now, no chastening for the presence is going to result in a Holy Ghost joy meeting. It doesn't seem to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, if you obey, if you listen, if you make the changes, if you humble yourself, if you deal right, look, the spirit of pride and the pride of life is very subtle. And I've watched as many people have come along someone, side of someone who was corrected by the Lord and say, oh, they didn't treat you fairly. That was so wrong for them to do that. And turn and harden the person's heart. And let me tell you something. It would be better that you had not entered into life than cause one of these little ones to stumble. It would be better that you, before you do that, you just go ahead and roll out to sea with a millstone and commit suicide. Throw the millstone in, tie the millstone to your neck and throw the millstone into the water. Because you turned someone away from the faith whom God was trying to bring into a place of being partaker of His holiness, to get it right, to move on with God, to grow and mature, to ultimately understand the things that were in their life hindering them from moving forward. Listen to me. I know what I'm talking about. You know why? The Word of God's living. It is powerful. It's like a searchlight. It reveals everything. When the Word of God goes forth, everything. It searches out every part of our being. Because it carries with it great conviction and carries with it the power of change, carries with it the miracle of salvation. And we either resist it because it's too intense, or we repent, we receive it, we humble ourselves, and the miracle takes place. The miracle of life. The miracle first and foremost of the new creation. Then the miracle of growth and maturity to where that we come and find ourselves in every way conforming to the image of Christ, being transfigured by the Word of God to where that Christ Jesus, His life and His power can be fully revealed through us. And no more do we live out our own life doing our own thing, but all of a sudden our mouth becomes filled with the convicting fiery Word of heaven, and people's hearts are made bare before Him, and lives are changed. And the whole beautiful thing of the advancement of the kingdom of God begins to unfold before our lives, and we get to participate with what we read about in the book of Acts. If you've not found the power to overcome sin and say no to sin, you've not found relationship with the Holy Ghost. You hear me? I have Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21 backing up what I just said. And you can either respond that with the woes and the poor me's, or you can say, help me, Father, I want that realm. I want that life. People think that Jesus Christ died at Calvary's cross so that people can continue living the same life that they've been living. No, He died and rose again so that anybody who wants to be delivered from sin and doesn't want to live in darkness anymore would have a way out. That anybody who wants out of hell can get into heaven. Who wants out of the life that is imposed upon you by men. Imposed upon you by death. Sin and death passed upon all men. Even though that we did not sin after the same similitude as Adam, it passed upon all men. Because of Adam's disobedience. But Christ Jesus' obedience and a spirit of obedience that comes and says, okay, I'm going to learn how to do it God's way. That's right. And when you're not doing it God's way, you better change. You better change, because the consequence is going to be not only your soul, but all the souls around you. It has a collateral damage. Your choices have a collateral damage, first for your house, then for everybody you've been able to influence. You better understand that God's way is not compromised, that His Word's not compromised, that the discerning of the Holy Ghost and the discerning of spirits and the Word of heaven that goes forth and the things that are revealed by the Lord are not compromisable. The way Father's laid things down in His Word and how He's described the order that is supposed to be in a person's house is not compromisable. You cannot compromise it and be right. And end up blessed. Now, I'm going to fight for you to be blessed. I'm going to fight for you to be blessed. I'm going to fight for you to be on the right side. You know why? Because Father's fighting for you. And if I'm with Him, I'm going to be fighting. Father's fighting. Holy Ghost fighting for you. Christ Jesus fighting for you. Ever living to pray and make intercession. Oh, if our hearts could just get hooked up with that part of His heart, we wouldn't be wandering around trying to figure out how to find time to pray. Find time to pray. You having to try to find time to pray is just a clear indication that you living your life for yourself. That's all it is. It's just a pure, clear revelation. Deal with reality. It's about time that you recognize what the fruits of your life are and whether or not that's what God described as you're supposed to have in your life. Because if we play games with God, His corrective word will never have impact on us. If we live in disobedience, if we really live in rebellion, His corrective word will not have any impact on us. That's why we read about, because this whole message of Hebrews is really about obeying the leaders. Go back and start at chapter 1, chapter 3, and chapter 4, ultimately highlighting, listen, if you're not going to obey the leaders, if you're going to walk in murmuring and complaining, if you're not going to follow the cloud of God's glory, understand, He's going to swear in His wrath you're not coming in either. That's a paraphrased version, but I'm telling you right now, it sums it up pretty accurately. You need to learn from the lessons that other people have already been taught. He says, but afterwards it yields the peaceable fruits of righteousness. See, I have two great indicators of whether or not I've been obeying God, listening to His correction and responding to His correction. I'm going to be made partaker of His holiness if I am, and I'm going to yield peaceable fruits of righteousness. If I'm not, if that's not going on, then there's someplace I'm not obeying God. Don't care how much I try to convince myself and say that I am, the fruits say that I'm not. And we are naked and exposed right now before Him with whom we have to do, because His word makes everything manifest, His light, unveils it all for us to see as well. It's time to be a living sacrifice. It's time to bind your hands and bind your feet and tie yourself to the horns of the altar and say, I don't live for me no more. I'm not living to do my own will. I'm going to be taught of God. I'm going to come under His instruction. I'm going to come under His correction. I'm going to come under His rule. Anywhere I see any kind of defiance or rebellion going on in my life, I'm going to shut it down. I'm going to be the first one to recognize it and say, my goodness, all hurt and offenses is nothing more than an outworking of defiance and rebellion. That's all it is. The stubbornness. That's all it is. And you say, I'm going to humble myself before God. I don't care how much it hurts. Hallelujah. Go ahead, let the righteous smite me. I'm going to be corrected. I'm going to be instructed in the ways of life. I want the peaceable fruits of righteousness. I want it partakers of His holiness. Hallelujah. I'm going to do it God's way. Mom, they say, I want, I'm going to tell you right now, I know that the name of the wicked should be blotted out. I know that if any of my seed or any of my loved ones didn't make heaven, I would not know them nor remember them. I understand that. But right now, I could not deal or bear the thought of anyone that I love not making heaven. Are you listening to me? I hope that you feel the same way. And I know what's gonna make the difference. It's not my opinion, your opinion, their opinion, some psychologist's opinion. It's what God says. So I know where the place of safety is. I know exactly what He said to do. And if we do it, we're going to get the results. We will get the results. Obedience will yield the results. It is absolute. It's not maybe. It's absolute. I'm telling you, it's absolute. This is absolute. You listen to me. This is absolute. It is unconditional. It is an absolute promise. It's an absolute promise. Guaranteed and backed up by Almighty God. When you understand that, then you're going to run and you're going to cleave to the Word of God and you're going to do it His way and you're going to say, my goodness, I understand why those who do not do the will of the Father aren't going to make it, because it's only by the will of the Father that we are preserved. And the will of the Father is perfectly exposed to us by the Word. Behold, I've come in the volume of the book. It is written to me to do Thy will. The living Word, who reveals the written Word, describes the will of God. Jesus said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is coming in, those who do the will of the Father. I expect the fire of God will get a hold of you tonight, because His word is like a fire. And it burns. Hallelujah. And it's like a sword and it cuts. And it slices things up to where that everything is perfectly made manifest so that we know exactly what we need to do. Hallelujah. And a big part of revival is somebody's going to be willing to stand up and start preaching the truth and quit holding men's persons in admiration and making merchandise out of individuals. And making church about a popularity club and what your polls are based upon what you preached. How many views you got for sharing the truth. Because this is really what it's turned into. It's a sad thing. But God's making people hungry. Wherefore, lift up holy hands. Wherefore, lift up those hands that hang down. Don't stand there feeling all downcast and overwhelmed. Strengthen the feeble knees. And let those things, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame turn you out of the way, but rather let it be healed. Let those things that have been identified as a problem, as causing issues, be healed. By saying, we're not doing it that way no more. We're not having it that way no more. We're going to make the changes in our life that need to be made. We're going to do it God's way. Father said, seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. And therefore, we're going to do it. He said, come out from among them and be separate. He said, do not be a friend with the world. He said, do not be a friend with the world. That's what He said. And whatever He says, whether we understand it or not, we're going to do it. And when He says something that almost sounds like a contradiction, we're going to understand the fine line that we must observe. When He tells us to love the world like He loved the world, gave His only begotten Son, but did not have any love for the world and not have any fellowship or friendship with it, we're going to understand the fine line. We're going to observe it. For God so loved the world, and we're supposed to have the same kind of a heart, but we have no love for the world. We hate the world. It's not a paradox. It's a heart, state of the heart, spiritual state of the heart. Father said, without holiness, it's impossible to see Him. He says, unless you've been born of the Spirit, it's impossible to see Him, to know Him. He says, for us to be holy even as He is holy, to be righteous even as He is righteous, to be pure just like He is pure, to walk as He walks, to be perfect even as He is perfect. And to the person who cries out to Him in truth and honesty and sincerity, He empowers them to be that. It's a gift. And He gives us the ability to have. It's the overcomer's life. It's the overcomer which God demands. This is the faith that overcomes. This is the power, the overcoming power that overcomes the world, or our victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Walking out this relationship with the Lord Jesus. Now the power of God is here. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is here to do it. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah.